This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond X Studios here, and holy shit, the Bush years were wacky. Another woman that can take your spot, my... One of the most fascinating things for me to watch as a fan of music over the past few years has been the writing of 2000s music into the legend of pop culture, and the legend that's been written thus far has been a very interesting and incredibly uneven one. The 2000s, more than anything, were defined by a million different trends, all moving in different and often opposite directions at the same time, like trains zooming in opposite directions to whichever destination at full speed and whose passing is a mere coincidence. Unlike the more homogenous and generally self-similar pop music of the 20th century, or the past 10 years where mainstream tastes have become more centralized as the lines between genres become blurrier and blurrier, it seems like everyone in the 2000s were all on completely different wavelengths to each other, turning popular music into a glorious, chaotic mess of paradoxes and bizarre trend shifting. A look at the pop charts of any week in the 2000s will see NSYNC going head-to-head with Ja Rule, or Kelly Clarkson competing with Nickelback, or Mariah Carey sharing the top 10 with Soulja Boy, a wild menagerie of Bush-era culture which is perfectly exemplified by the list of songs that hit number one. 130 different songs peaked atop the Hot 100 throughout the 2000s decade, and in this video, we're going to be taking a look at every single one of them, and ranking them from my least favorite to my personal favorite. From the TRL pop of 2000, to the Crunkin' B of 2004, to the Atlanta ringtone rap of 2006, to the legendary club boom of 2009, the childhoods of 2000s kids were defined by a wider range of genre than quite possibly any generation before or since. There's a lot to look at with this musical catamaran of a decade, so let's stand up, say it right, and lose ourselves in the moment as we count down. Yeah, it's just like the ocean under the moon. It's the same as the emotion that I get from you. You got the kind of love that can be so smooth. Yeah. Give me your heart, make it real, or else forget about it. Okay, so before we get too deep into this, let's quickly go over some background and set some rules. Like I said, we're gonna be looking at the 130 songs which peaked at number one on the Billboard Hot 100 between the first week of January 2000 and the last week of December 2009. However, let's be clear, and I can't stress this enough, this is not meant to be a list of the most important, most beloved, or even the most successful hits of the decade. In both 2000 and 2001, the best performing songs in the United States by pure numbers did not hit number one on the Hot 100. And then you've also got acts like The Strokes, Norah Jones, and System of a Down who moved millions of CDs and yet barely touched the Hot 100 at all. If a song is on this list, all that means is that, for at least one week in the 2000s, it was the most successful song in the United States according to Billboard. And, let's just say that Billboard used to be a lot less reliable. Unlike today, where the Billboard charts are mainly calculated on radio play, digital sales, and streaming performance, the charts in the first half of the 2000s were calculated exclusively through radio play and the sale of physical singles. This meant that if you wanted a song you were listening to count for the Hot 100, you couldn't just stream the album or even buy the album on a CD. Oh no, you needed to buy either a CD or a 7-inch vinyl, which would contain only that one song, a couple remixes and instrumentals of that one song, and maybe a B-side if you were lucky. It was a horribly archaic system, and considering that most teenagers were pirating music off of Napster and LimeWire in 2000, and Billboard didn't count either of those, yeah, let's just say that the Hot 100 gave a somewhat narrow view of what people were actually listening to back then. I was born in 1997. Every song in this video hit number one during my lifetime, and yet I had literally never heard a distressing number of these songs before I started researching this video. I certainly wouldn't blame you if you came here expecting me to talk about Green Day, Missy Elliott, and Linkin Park, none of whom have ever hit number one, and you walk away wondering who the hell Paul Wall, B2K, and Vertical Horizon are. Thankfully, Billboard finally counted digital songs for the Hot 100 starting in 2005, and on-demand streaming in 2007. So the later you go in the decade, the more accurately the charts reflected people's actual tastes. But yeah, this is all just a long-winded, roundabout way of saying that I'm not the one who picked which songs appear on this list, so don't get mad at me about it. Even putting issues with chart accuracy aside, the fact is that millions millions of people did in fact buy and listen to every single song on this list, even the ones you've never heard of. Please keep that in mind, along with the fact that while I may not have picked which songs appear on this list, the order that these songs appear on this list is based entirely on my own completely subjective opinion. If you disagree with the order of any song on this list, feel free to leave a comment politely explaining why so we can have a nice and civil conversation about it. Or leave a comment telling me that I'm a mushbrain jackass who should really stop shitting into his own mouth. Either way, it'll be good for the algorithm. Beyond the ordering, I'll also be putting the songs into tiers of quality, starting with the terrible songs and then moving our way through the bad, meh, decent, good, excellent, and finally, the exceptional songs. And now, without further ado, let's start off the terrible tier by taking a look at what is, in my opinion, the worst number one hit of the entire 2000s decade. You're beautiful. Yep, this is where we're starting. My pick for the worst number one hit of the 2000s is You're Beautiful by James Blunt. Or as I like to call it, the massive creeper Someone You Loved. A lot of you are probably wondering what I mean by that. You probably remember this song as that intensely annoying but ultimately harmless thing that was everyone's least favorite part of listening to the radio in 2006. I mean, I'm sure you won't disagree with me when I say James Blunt sings like a pretentious, socially awkward drama kid choking on his own lungs. Ironic that this literal military captain sounds like he'd be knocked over by a light breeze. But why are you calling this so creepy, Sean? Isn't it just a cute little love song? No. Actually, this song is about a crackhead ogling a random woman he's never met before on the subway.
She smiled at me on the subway. She was with another man. But I won't lose no sleep on that, cause I've got a plan.
Yeah, that's the subject of this song. I'm not reaching, I'm not looking too deep into it. This song is literally about a guy, high on drugs, sitting on the subway, catching a woman's eye, and then just staring at her and fantasizing about all the things he wants to do to her. And the more in-depth he goes, the more you have no choice but to imagine yourself as that woman, sitting in that subway car, getting leered down by some creepy guy sitting across from you and knowing that you're just trapped in that awful situation until the subway finally reaches your stop.
She could see from my face that I was fucking high, and I don't think that I'll see her again, but we shared a moment that will last till the end.
I used to just think this song was irritating and badly sung, but now that I've actually paid attention to the lyrics, I can safely say that there are very few songs, let alone number one hits, that make me feel this intensely uncomfortable. It really sucks because James Blunt seems like a perfectly nice, wholesome guy in real life, but my God, does he just not come across that way in his music. Because I went and listened to some of his other songs and, well, let's just say that that creepiness was not an isolated incident.
Yes, I saw you were blinded, and I knew I had one, so I took what's mine by eternal right.
Oh my God, dude, stop that. Just fucking stop that right now. My God, gross. Ew. Okay, yeah, I think I've made my point. If you think anything about this song is cute or endearing, go listen to From Above by Ben Folds and Nick Hornsby. It does what this song was trying to do 100 times better. And that's all I have to say about You're Beautiful by James Blunt, my least favorite number one hit of the 2000s. I will say, though, that it wasn't like James Blunt just waltzed into that spot unopposed. The race to the bottom was a pretty damn close one. Honestly, this song is probably what you expected at the bottom of this list, considering that Laffy Taffy by D4L is widely considered to be the worst hit rap song of all time, with the lamest beat ever, one of the lamest flows ever, and possibly the single lamest brag in the history of hip-hop. Yeah, I can imagine this dude just sitting there trying to think of a wham line involving a candy as tiny as his dick is. Passing over such incredible options as You Can Call Me Wonka Nerd because I'm sour and misshapen, and Call Me Tic Tac because you'll smell me on your breath for hours when I'm done with you. So yeah, purely on the level of aesthetics, this is all-time worse in pretty much every category. And that's not even getting to the line about groping strippers against their will when the bouncer's back is turned.
Girl, let me touch you. I will never tell. The security guard don't scare nobody. Damn right.
Like I said, the race to rock bottom was a very close one. It might seem strange at the outset to put a song as peppy and upbeat as Girlfriend this incredibly low, but let me be perfectly clear. There are very few songs in the world I want to yell at to just shut the fuck up as much as this one.
Don't pretend I think you know I'm damn precious. And hell yeah, I'm the motherfucking princess.
is the most bratty and insufferable song I've ever heard in my life. It's like listening to Regina George fused with Ariana Grande on Seven Rings. It's all the worst stereotypes of catty, spoiled, insufferable, mean girls being shoved directly into your ear with no reprieve for the entire thing. We're living in a post-Olivia Rodrigo world now. There are so many amazing hit songs by teenagers about their own lives, thoughts, and feelings. And some of those songs can get pretty bratty too, but there's an art to them, a reason why they are what they are. This song only exists because a sexual predator wanted to make a lot of money.
He's like, so whatever, you can do so much better.
Yeah, that's right. Girlfriend was the first number one hit ever for one Dr. Luke, who, if you didn't know, is the producer Kesha sued for emotionally and sexually abusing her, who got off the hook because, to paraphrase the judge, we can't prove he's a rapist and we can't lock him up just for being a scumbag. Avril Lavigne has gone on record and said that this is an album that she feels no personal connection to. She just handed the reins off to her producers because her sales were flagging and she needed hits. So yeah, Girlfriend isn't even a song that comes from a bratty, insufferable teenage girl. It's a song that comes from a creepy middle-aged man cosplaying as a bratty, insufferable teenage girl.
There's no other, so is it gonna sink in? She's so stupid, what the hell were you thinking?
I mean, clearly it worked, considering that Girlfriend was both Avril's only number one hit and the first YouTube video ever to pass 100 million views. But considering that this song also clearly marked the beginning of the end for Avril, this is one victory I think that we can all agree was pretty damn pharic.
I'm by your train.
And here we have the first song that doesn't really have any objectionable lyrical content in it, but it's still one of the slimiest, sludgiest pieces of music I've ever heard. I feel like my sinuses need irrigating after listening to it. The melodies and harmonies all rise and fall randomly and out of sync with each other. The one main melody it chooses to repeat over and over is horribly cloying. And it's not helping that T-Pain's autotune is slathered all over it like an Applebee's steak waterboarded in ketchup. Look, I'm not against excessive autotune at all. There's definitely a time and place for cool distorted robot vocals, but the time is not 2007, and the place is not when T-Pain wants me to think about his O-face.
We in the bed line.
There are many things I would change if I were to remake my worst hit songs of 2007 video, but one of the biggest would be to put this song on the list all the way down at number 2. Which means, yes, I hate this song even more than...
Well, I know you see me looking at you and you already know I wanna fuck you.
God, 2007 was a bad year. I feel like I don't need to make a point about the lyrics, they kinda speak for themselves. Nor do I need to say much about Akon. His voice has always rubbed me the wrong way, and I think that's because I've never heard the man get as into anything as he's gotten into drooling in his lap over these strippers. This was also the first time I ever realized that Snoop Dogg's power has limits. I desperately wanted to believe that he could make literally anything cool, but seeing him drag down to Akon's level here was like seeing my parents cry for the first time, or seeing Mickey Mouse take off his head at Disney World. It just shattered something sacred that I didn't even know could be shattered.
I'm stuck on pussy and yours is right. Rip riding the poles and them doughs is tight.
This song is deplorable. It's enough to make me repulsed at the mere concept of sex, which is amazing considering that I'm such a big fan of sex. I mean, I'm a real, certified sex-haver, and yet here this song is, and it's making me talk like a fucking virgin, which is just so cringy and off-brand for me. Let me be perfectly clear that this channel is a strict anti-virgin zone. Seriously, if you've ever been a virgin in your life, get the fuck out.
I take you to the candy shop.
This is a song I've already done a full review on. You can go check that out if for some reason you're in the mood for an in-depth breakdown on why Candy Shop by 50 Cent is, in fact, a bad song. Really, the only relevant thing you need to know for this video is that this is the worst of many, many shitty chart toppers produced by Scott Storch, a protege of Timbaland who made and then lost a fortune as a white-hot beatmaker by doing literally everything wrong that Timbaland did right. Basically, anytime you hear a flat, bland, car sickness-inducing beat from the 2000s built on a Middle Eastern sounding riff, it's probably him. And going forward, I'll be sure to point out every one of his number one hits by using my patented Storch Stork. I'm sure you'll get an idea of his sound pretty quickly. So this next song is probably the most love it or hate it song of the entire 2000s decade. If you're one of the people who love it, then I'm sorry. And if you're one of the people who hate it, oh my god, I'm so much sorrier.
I bet you want the body.
I'm not not gonna lie, I'm not a fan of Ciara even at the best of times. I've barely been able to get into anything she's done, not only because she so obviously and desperately wanted to be Beyonce, but because trying to be Beyonce is the kind of thing that completely falls apart if you do it even 99% right. And frankly, I don't think Ciara's ever made it out of the mid-80s. The high whistling G-funk synth is obviously the most make it or break it part of this. You either think it's one of the worst sounds you've ever heard in your life, or you don't get what people are complaining about, and I'm definitely further towards the former, but I think that Ciara herself is just as big an irritant as the production. I just do not get the appeal of this at all, and the fact that this was apparently the 31st biggest hit of the entire decade, well, I feel the same way about that I do about Big Mouth getting 100% on Rotten Tomatoes. Like, even if you somehow like it, we can all agree that's overselling it a bit, right?
So crack a bottle, let your body waddle, don't act like a snobby model, you just hit the ladder.
This song is just as bad as anything off of Encore, and I don't know how anyone could dispute that. It sounds like a shitty SNL parody of Eminem rather than the real thing. I mean, even putting aside the fact that he introduces himself as one of the greatest villains of all time by bragging about the number of rapes he's committed, and trust me, that is not an easy thing to put aside, but even if you do ignore that, the only thing more stilted and awkward than his flow on this song are the rest of the lyrics he chose to go with.
Just one of my mother's sons who got thrown under the bus. Kiss my butt, lick from under cheese from under my nuts.
Fucking embarrassing. If you're someone who thinks Eminem doesn't deserve to be called a legend of hip-hop, this song is one of the best pieces of ammo that you've got. Oh, and also, for a song that's supposed to be a celebration of M's brothers in the industry by bringing on both his mentor Dr. Dre and his protege 50 Cent, I do have to ask why M and 50 both sound less invested on this song than they did when they both showed up on a fucking Ed Sheeran song together. There will be people out there who think I'm only being so harsh on this song because of what an awful human being Chris Brown is, but let me be clear. I don't put songs on the list because they were made by terrible people. I put songs on the list because they were made by terrible artists, and Chris Brown is a terrible artist. I mean, this song came out when he was a teenager before he went psycho. I'm never gonna be less bothered by Chris Brown's mere existence on the song than I am right now, but even at a base level, he just comes across as an insufferable little punk brat in the same way that Justin Bieber would just a few years later. Except at least 2009, Justin Bieber could actually sing.
So kitty shouty. We parking lot, baby, to my dog. I know what you want.
This is fucking insufferable. The melody on Kiss Kiss slides all over the place, and the production is overflowing with the same overstuffed digital audio vomit as Buy You a Drink, which is fitting considering that T-Pain produced both of these two songs within a few months of each other. But wait a minute, if Chris Brown's voice is already completely slathered in auto-tune to the point of unrecognizability, then what exactly is T-Pain gonna do on his verse?
You think I'll be hollering if you not.
He's gonna hork like a beach dolphin with asthma getting fisted. Okay, I have to admit, that is a new one. I did not see that one coming.
Teddy Bender.
What the hell is that? Sounds like owls having sex.
You think I'd be hollering if you not.
Yeah, for anyone who's ever wished that T-Pain wouldn't use so much auto-tune, well, congratulations, this is the sound of your monkey's paw curling and then being shoved directly up T-Pain's ass. I was originally gonna put this song at number 121 just for the meme, but I think this is a perfect spot for it, actually.
Girl, it's easy to love me now. Would you love me if I was down and out?
In a lot of ways, this song is pretty solid as far as 50 Cent goes. It's got a nice, smooth little R&B groove under it, and I could listen to Nate Dogg reading the phone book and I'd be turned on by it, minimum homo. So yeah, if you don't pay attention to the lyrics, this song does have a pretty decent amount going for it, but oh, good lord, those lyrics.
If I got locked up and sentenced to a quarter century, could I count on you to be there to support me mentally?
Look, I'm not really a fan of songs whose main sentiment is basically any version of if you can't handle me at my worst, you don't deserve me at my best. But that's not even what 21 Questions is. It's more like if you can't handle me at my worst, then you don't deserve me at my base level of operation. This entire song is just Fitty going on and on about how he's fully aware that his stupid decisions are gonna make his partner's life worse through his presence in it, but he's still demanding that she pledge her complete and total loyalty to him, even if he's not pledging it back to her in return.
If I was with some other chick and someone happened to see, and when you asked me about it, I said it wasn't me. Would you believe me or up and leave me? How deep is our bond if that's all it takes for you to be gone? We only humans, girl, we make mistakes.
That's right. Even before the relationship really starts, this dude is already building an escape ladder in case he gets caught cheating.
Girl, I
was caught up in her lust.
And on the topic of cheating assholes being assholes about cheating, we've got this train wreck here. This is one of those songs where every little thing about it is obnoxious. From the repetition, to the stuttering, to the egregious auto-tune, to the shitty out-of-place sampling. It's like an awful kidney stone of all the worst musical traits of the 2000s that we collectively had to pass before the 2010s could properly begin. I do think that the chorus is the worst thing about it, considering how cynical and out of place it is.
So tell me, girl,
what you say, that you only meant.
I've said this before, but I just have to reiterate that Jason Derulo has been in the spotlight for over a decade now, and the only two number one hits he's ever managed to get were him just grabbing the biggest meme he could get his hands on and just stamping OC Do Not Steal on them. I'm legitimately shocked that he didn't try to sample fucking We Are Number One or some shit back in 2016. But lazy sampling aside, do you want to know what the second worst part of this song is?
When the roof caved in and the truth came out, I just didn't know what to do.
Yeah, his response to getting caught cheating is, yeah, well, I'm about to be a celebrity, so you're obviously gonna stick around anyways, who cares? So there was this weird trend that went on for the first few years of the decade where these glamorous, cooing pop princesses would team up with gravelly-voiced gangsta rappers to create either ill-conceived, misshapen remixes or original songs that sounded like ill-conceived, misshapen remixes.
It must be the ass that got me like that.
Even beyond Ja Rule's Marlboro-voiced whale songing at the beginning, J-Lo's got several conflicting vocal lines going at any time, and the entire thing's got this playground-taunt melody running through the mix that sounds like it's being played on a steel pan drum covered in duct tape.
Now I'm seeing that you're kinda lame, knowing how the situation changed. Falling late.
There's no need to go in deep on this one. It's one of the most reviled songs of the decade, and everyone already knows why it sucks. And the fact that there are so many songs below it on this list is really just an indicator of how many contenders there were in the race for the absolute worst number one hit of the 2000s. I promise that there will eventually be some really amazing songs on this list. I actually like more number one hits from this decade than I dislike, but yeah, we've still got a lot of shit to wade through before we get there. As for now, here's a fun fact. Did you know that With Arms Wide Open by Creed actually comes from the fifth biggest album of the entire 2000s decade? Yeah. By pure numbers, Human Clay by Creed was just as definitional to the 2000s as Beer Bongs and Bentleys was to the 2010s. Which I guess just goes to prove the old adage that sad white boy's gonna sad white boy. Oh, and this is completely unrelated to the music, but if you were to ask me which of these two guys' cars probably smelled worse, I would say Scott Stapp with no hesitation. And you have no idea what a legendary feat it is to lose that contest to Post Goddamn Malone.
Telling you all those lies to get on your side, but I must admit there was a couple secrets I held inside.
Like I mentioned, Akon is a guy who, even when he's not singing I Wanna Fuck You, really sounds like he wants to be singing I Wanna Fuck You. And that just makes it inherently gross anytime he tries to get romantic. Don't Matter is just this slimy, weaselly little pickled oyster of a song that just glumps along awkwardly without doing anything for 5 excruciating minutes. There's only one even mildly catchy part of the entire song, and that's the part he just straight up stole from Bob Marley. Oh man, on the subject of straight up stealing shit from better artists.
I'm hot cause I'm fly, you ain't cause you not, not. This is why I'm hot.
The story of Mips the Rabbit, I mean Mims the Rapper, who came out of nowhere with a shitty number one hit explaining how amazing he is and then immediately disappeared off the face of the earth, has become the stuff of bad music legend. But I bet a lot of people who have heard of this song haven't actually listened to any of it besides the chorus. So why is Mims so hot, you ask? I mean, at a glance, this just sounds like a halfway passable-ish generic hard beat dragged down to near unlistenable levels by the quarter rapping over it. A quarter is what I call half-baked 50 cent ripoffs, just to clarify. So if the kid himself has no demonstrated talents as an MC, then what makes him so hot? Plagiarism. Lots and lots of plagiarism.
Copping the Hollywood as soon as I hit LA. I'm in that low, I do what the Cali way.
Yeah, my best guess is that this song only got any attention because half of it is just him grabbing beats from other hits and jamming them in basically unaltered.
People say that I'm fly, they love the way I dress, they like my attire.
You know, I can't believe I'm saying this, but at least Salento didn't play Crank That's Beat when he did the Superman in Watch Me. So yeah, there is nothing to this guy, this song, or anything orbiting around either of them. But I'm gonna ask you to stay tuned, viewers, because believe it or not, Mims will be popping up in this ranking again at some point. So keep your eyes open.
Hot shit. Hot shit. Yeah, I'm going down.
Wait. Oh, hold up. Something's not right here. That song never hit number one. And also, that song is actually good. So, oh, damn it. I think I must have played the wrong track. Can we take that again from the top, please?
Oh, shit! Oh, shit!
Are you ready for this?
There we go. London Bridge by Fergie is one of the most aggressively unpleasant listening experiences in the history of popular music. The instrumental producer Paulo Dadon came up with for this song legitimately sounds like a double-decker bus crashing into a marching band in the middle of a traffic jam on the actual London Bridge. Fergie whoops and floops out a clunky piss-take rap, spouting out every insufferable party girl cliche she can think of and sounding drunk off her ass doing it. As you can tell by the pouring sound, they decided to shove directly into your ear.
Drinks get pouring and my speech starts slurring, everybody start looking real sure.
So, yeah, I don't know if I've ever heard a song more worthy of being called a train wreck than this one. It's legitimately just Selfie by the Chainsmokers with cliches from a decade earlier and none of the self-awareness. And yet, I still vastly prefer London Bridge to Selfie, and there's one reason for that. I've heard a ton of shitty songs that sound exactly like Selfie. I've never heard another shitty song that sounds anything remotely like London Bridge, and I would be lying if I said I didn't have some perverse respect for that. The MO of the Black Eyed Peas has always been to see just how annoying they could get away with being, and with London Bridge, Fergie is pushing that experiment to its absolute limit, and I find that to be utterly intriguing. I mean, say what you will about a train wreck, but it is impossible to look away from. Five, four, three, two, and one. Okay, cool, you're still here. So, yeah, for the 8 of you who didn't immediately click off the video after I put the haha funny April 30th meme song in the terrible tier, you're probably wondering how I could possibly put one of the most iconic songs of the entire TRL era in the same tier as London Bridge and Creed. Well, the simple answer to that question is that I just listened to the lyrics. You see, the basic setup here is that a girl has recently gone through a tough breakup, and JTS here are trying to get into her newly vacated pants. So how do they choose to do this? Well, by saying shit like this.
You got no choice, babe, but to move on. You don't wanna lose it again. You're just too blind to see. But in the end, you know it's gonna be me. You can't deny.
Yeah. The entire lyrical drive behind this song is you've been mourning your last relationship long enough, so you'd better cut that shit out and get with me right now because I'm starting to get impatient.
Baby, when you find
yeah, the more you listen to this, the more the phrase "it's gonna be me" starts to sound a little bit like a threat. God, I hope that all the kids who listen to this didn't get the impression that this is how relationships are supposed to work. Honestly, thinking about it from that angle makes this song look kinda reprehensible. Eh, at least it slaps though.
Get money maker like somebody bought a player. I see you on my radar, don't you act like you were afraid of she.
Comedy tends to be one of the forms of media that is the quickest and worst to age, and while Ludacris certainly wasn't a comedy rapper, he was often aiming to get at least a chuckle out of you, which usually worked. But when it flopped, man, it flopped hard. Moneymaker is just an empty beat Pharrell must have yanked out of his recycling bin at the last moment before emptying, over which he mumbled out a barely audible hook which clashes badly against Luda's awkward, overhyped yelping.
Took your mama 9 months to make, yeah? Might as well shake what your mama gave, yeah?
Not a single element in this song is anywhere near cool or hype, and frankly, it seems like a song that nobody involved particularly cared much about. I will concede that it does have its moments of being so bad it's good.
Let me give you some swimming lessons on the penis!
But those are the exception. For the most part, it's bad ringtone rap, which is well below par for both men in the title.
You should let me love you. Let me be the one to give you everything.
This one's just depressing, man. The 2000s as a decade were defined by hip-hop-flavored R&B love songs, by men and women, hard and smooth. That was the biggest sound of the 2000s, and yet the genre's biggest hit of the entire decade was this weak, insincere, nothing burger, treat you better shit. This song was more successful than every single R&B hit Usher had in the 2000s, and I'm pretty sure just mentioning that fact out loud is enough to get you executed in several countries.
They say we're too young to get ourselves sprung.
This one is pretty self-evidently awful, with a bizarre combination of a slow, plodding tempo, squeaky, ear-grating vocals, and morbid, pathetic lyrics.
You have me suicidal, suicidal, when you say it's over.
It's
This is a song about how you'd better keep your guard up because 16-year-old Chris Brown is planning on stealing your girl from you.
I can definitely show you things. Have you saying I can't be 16?
Now, in a reasonable world, this would have instantly buried this kid under an avalanche of ridicule and we never would have heard from him again. But alas, we decided to instantly embrace this twerp with open arms, a decision that we are still paying for a decade and a half later. I will give Chris Brown credit for one thing, though. On both of his number one hits, he is not the worst part of them. That honor on Run It goes to Jewel Santana, a friend of Cam'ron who did a few high-profile features at the time and might very well be the single most underhated rapper of the entire decade.
Let's do it like the yin-yang twin star whispering.
Oh my god, seriously? Is this seriously another rapper who got a number one hit by doing nothing but stealing other people's songs?
I know what girls want, I know what they like.
Holy shit, first Mims and now this guy. How the hell do we keep letting this happen?
You tell your friends to get with my friends, we could be friends.
You know what, fuck it, I'm not gonna stand for this. Let me just state, clearly and for the record, that if you steal trademarks totally unaltered from people infinitely more successful, recognizable, and talented than you, then you're a complete scumbag, and frankly, you have no place in polite society. Fucking hack. I knew at some point I'd have to just rip off the band-aid and say it, so here we go. Most of Beyoncé's number one hits this decade were not good. I don't care if I'm gonna get stung to death for saying that, I'm gonna speak my piece, starting with Single Ladies, which is an absolute migraine of a song. It's awkward, herky-jerky, way too loud in all the wrong places, and the instrumental in the second half of the chorus sounds like it's going to eat me. Beyoncé has plenty of songs shouting out her ladies, but this one takes the shouting part of that a bit too literally. This is another one where I just want more than anything for her to just shut up. And don't give me the whole, oh, you just can't handle a woman being forcefully confident. No, stuff it. I've been vouching for women kicking ass on record the entire time I've been doing this job. It's just that if you're gonna get all up in my face, you'd better have a damn good reason for it. And this song is just so shouty, ugly, and needlessly aggressive that I feel like I'm covered in spit every time I'm finished listening to it.
Treat me to the things of the world. I'm not that kind of girl.
I can only assume this song is so beloved because of the whole Single Ladies put your hands up call and response in the chorus, which is certainly unignorable, but has been done way better in a ton of other songs, as well as the music video, which, I mean, it's iconic, let's be real. Even to someone who can't stand this song, I will fully admit that Beyoncé had one of the greatest videos of all time. I know it's not a particularly good look for me to shit on Britney Spears at the moment, considering that she just recently fought her way out of her father's legal control, and a lot of people are reevaluating the extremely harsh treatment we've all given her over the past decade and a half. I'm certainly not going to disagree with that assessment. Britney Spears is clearly one of the most important and influential artists of the 21st century, and she certainly deserves to be respected for that. But I'm sorry, the entire Circus album has aged like an apple core on a sidewalk. Womanizer honestly might be the best single purely because it takes the least risks, and so it stumbles marginally less than the others. It sucks, because Britney Spears was such an incredible force of personality for the first few years of her career. She completely owned her music and was utterly impossible to look away from, but Britney has no presence on Womanizer. She just sounds like a cheap Chinese knockoff of Hitsune Miku, just a vocal plugin spouting out the lyrics of some music industry hacks without any personal connection or impact. Oh, and the fact that it also sounds like it was written by a shitty AI isn't helping matters.
Womanizer, woman, womanizer, you're a womanizer, oh.
I've been thinking about this relationship, and I wanna know, is it as good as it gets?
This is a pop song where Ja Rule tries to be a smooth, seductive lover boy, and J-Lo brags about how down-to-earth and real she is, despite the fact that Ja Rule sings like a pufferfish just blew up in his windpipe, and J-Lo is fucking J-Lo. The instrumental is pretty nice, I'll give it that, but that's only because it's sampled directly from Mary Jane by Rick James. So yeah, anytime you're listening to this, you're making the active choice not to listen to Rick James, and instead to listen to Boris and Natasha serenading their own egos with the sweet melodic stylings of a strep-throated bullfrog and all the charm and humility of a Kardashian on My Super Sweet 16.
Lift me up in your eyes.
Hey, remember remember that time that American Idol? Because I do. Well, in passing, I mean. I never watched the show, but American Idol used to have a death grip on the American consciousness. Enough so that you basically got a free week or two at number one on the charts if you ended up winning, or getting second in the case of Clay Aitken. As for the song itself, well, there's really not that much to say about it, except that it's the manifestation of everything you think about when you think of bad TV talent show music. Being insufferably corny, bland, overdone, and faux inspirational to the most extreme degree. And for the record, I'm not the only one who thought that.
Whereas I hated that song and I hope they don't make that your first single.
I agree with Randy.
What I didn't like about it was like American Idol the musical.
Yeah, the song's terrible.
Yeah, if you've made a song that's too sappy and cliched for American Idol judges, then you've ascended to a very special level of failure, typically only reserved for the front page of iFunny. Also, remember back when American Idol started and the judges weren't afraid to be just giant douchebags?
What's astonishing is how handsome this show has made you. I mean, seriously. I mean, you look back on those early clips. I'm not being rude, but you really were ugly then, and now you're handsome.
Allow smacking your ass and fucking.
Whoever gave Ja Rule the idea that he was capable of singing deserves to be tarred and feathered. And on that same note, we've got T.I., one of the pioneers of trap music who broke away from the genre in 2008 to go full pop with his album Paper Trail, which featured several of the most successful and peculiar hits of the entire decade. I say peculiar because T.I.'s trap music was very good, and his pop music was... not.
Anytime you want to pick up the telephone, you know it ain't meant to drop a couple stacks on you.
Here's all you need to know about Whatever You Like. I don't know if I've ever heard anyone rip a song off as hard as Soulja Boy ripped off Whatever You Like when he made Kiss Me Through the Phone. And Kiss Me Through the Phone is literally twice as fun, twice as catchy, and twice as charming as Whatever You Like is. This song is outdone by its own Soulja Boy knockoff. I can't even wrap my head around that. Like, imagine if Nintendo stopped producing Switch games and instead they decided to just rip off the Soulja Boy game console by selling an absurdly overpriced collection of ROM dumps. Wait.
It started when we were younger, you were mine.
Look, I get that people have a lot of nostalgia for this one. It's a collaboration between the biggest male and female R&B stars of the decade. The sentiment is really cute, and this is probably one of the most R-song songs ever to come out. But I implore you to rip off those nostalgia blinds and give it another listen, because it has aged terribly. And no, I'm not even talking about the lyrics, although I've always found boo to be an obnoxiously cutesy way of describing anything that's not a cat or a child capable of powering a city by laughing. No, when I say this is aged badly, I'm talking about the way it sounds.
Bring it back. I don't know about Shaw, but I know about us. It's the only way we know how to rock.
You've got Usher switching at random between this forceful hip-hop delivery and his breathy cooing. Alicia Keys is rapping for half of it. The two of them are constantly talking over each other. There's all these weird little vocal watermarks sprinkled all over it. There's a weird minor key trill that juts in at random and just makes my skin crawl.
And you were my
This song really does die by a thousand cuts. It's very off-putting in a way that's very hard to describe. And before you jump in to defend this song to me, please go give it a listen and see if it's really as good as you remember it.
Touch my body, put me on the floor.
My friend Diane said in her Worst Hit Songs of 2008 video that this song sounds like a computer generating a Mariah Carey song. And for the most part, yeah, that's basically why I don't like it. The production just sounds like you picked out some Mariah Carey background presets on GarageBand and completely missed the point of them, while the melody is mostly just awkward warbling between two notes. And that's before you get to the lyrics. It should not be difficult to make a good song with the message of Mariah Carey wants to have sex with you. But for some inexplicable reason, Mariah spends a not insignificant portion of the song saying, if you secretly record us fucking or even mention it to anyone else, I swear to God, I'm gonna fucking kill you.
If just a camera up and hit in a best night, I just look on YouTube. Close a beer on your mouth and brag about the secret rendezvous. I will hunt you down.
So, apparently in Mariah's eyes, I'm not a loving partner who she can trust and confide in. I'm a potential creep who has to be told off and threatened before I've even done anything wrong. And I'm not gonna lie, I don't particularly feel like listening to a song that makes those assumptions about me. And here we have the worst possible outcome of the phrase, let's make a Justin Timberlake type song. I have to admit, I thought Usher was better than this. Granted, this was his big comeback single 4 years after Confession, so he basically could have done whatever he wanted to and it would have been a giant smash. But still, listen to this. Weak-ass vocals, obnoxious jittering synth beat, crooning lyric where he just repeats over and over again that he can't keep it in his pants and just wants to fuck the girl in the middle of the club without caring who watches. You could tell me this was a Jason Derulo song and I wouldn't bat an eye at that. And that is a fuck-up so royal, it's Rolling Stone's pick for the 30th best song ever made. Do I make you In hindsight, it makes a lot of sense that the time we let a guy named Taylor Hicks have the number one song in the country from the moment it was released was the moment we said, hey, you know what? Maybe this whole American Idol thing isn't working out so well after all. It's so funny. Nowadays, songs debuting at number one on the charts are so common that Wikipedia doesn't even bother to list them all anymore, but for the entire 2000s decade, only 5 songs debuted on top of the charts, and 4 of them were from American Idol. But then again, before American Idol, songs only debuted at number one because of a loophole where Billboard only added certain songs to the charts after they'd already been building up momentum for months. So yeah, the moral of the story is that Billboard has literally always been bullshit, and a song debuting at number one has never meant anything. And in your eyes, I see the missing pieces. The first few years of the 2000s for Billboard were basically just a couple extra years of the 90s, with the success of Savage Garden being a prime example of that. These guys combine all the worst elements of boy bands with all the worst elements of easy listening. Every single song of theirs sounds exactly the same as the last, with the only thing making this particular song stand out being the lyrics, which... When someone says, I loved you the moment I laid eyes on you, it's corny and overdone. But when someone says, I love you before I laid eyes on you, I mean, if this song had come out in the age of Tinder, then whatever, the song would just be textbook boilerplate creeper shit. But for someone to say something like that in the age of dial-up, it's just sappy, meaningless, and overwrought. It's a holdover from a more innocent time that has absolutely no business existing in 21st century pop culture. But then again, I guess by the year 2000, the internet was prominent enough that the music industry had lost enough share to allow shit like this to hit the top of the charts. So yeah, I think I'm gonna assume that this song is just about the guy from Savage Garden telling a girl he met on AOL in a chat room how deeply obsessed with her he is. Hot. Oh, baby boy, you stay in my mind, fulfill my fantasy. Come on, girl, tell me how you feel. Yeah, so remember what I said about how being Beyonce only works when it's done 100% right? Yeah, well, that's no different for Beyonce herself than it is for any of her wannabes. I remember a while ago, I watched a video where Your Movie Sucks was going through the bonus features for The Lion King 2019, and he was absolutely gobsmacked by how everyone literally seemed to worship Beyonce, like to the point where they didn't let people talk about their actual parts in the film and only what it was like to work with her. That was really eye-opening for me. I didn't realize the intensity with which actual, real-life people literally deified this woman, and I don't know if there's a faster way to kill that perspective than by listening to Baby Boy, which reduces Beyonce to the most disposable, nondescript, bog-standard pop vocalist you can imagine, crooning out nothing lyrics over a stiff-ass Scott Storch beat with a couple token Sean Paul bars dropped in between that do nothing to liven anything up. This is just a normal, bad pop song that Beyonce adds nothing to, and if she weren't on it, there would be nothing worth saying about it. Ooh, are you looking like you like what you see? Won't you come over and check up on it? And all that also applies to this one, too. Honestly, I'm coming to realize more and more that Beyonce has just never been a good singles artist. Even if I do get uncomfortable with just how obsessed people can get with her, I can't deny that Beyonce is best at doing big things and making huge statements. And on a lot of her biggest pop hits, she just does absolutely nothing noteworthy. This one does flow a little better than Baby Boy, but it's somehow even more repetitive. I swear that Bey is just hitting one single melody over and over. Again, just ask yourself, if this didn't have the name Beyonce on it, would you even pay it a second thought?
Are y'all ready, kids?
Aye, aye, Captain!
I can't hear you!
Aye, aye, Captain!
Oh!
Soldier boy, I'm in it. Oh. Why me crack it, why me roll?
This is a case where the song itself is definitely bad, but the soft spot it's earned in everyone's hearts is definitely warranted. Crank That was the first song ever to hit number one because of memes and internet promotion. It's literally groundbreaking in that regard, and it's got what I can confidently say with hindsight is a stupidly fun hook that's guaranteed to fill a dance floor. Unfortunately, literally everything about the song that isn't the hook is sloppy, gross, and drags all the energy and fun to a stop, just like all the shitty Vine hits that came in its wake.
It's me at your local party, yes I crank it every day.
haters get mad cause I got me some bathing ape.
I spent all morning watching a VH1 special on Gwen Stefani. I don't know what a hollaback girl is. All I know is I want her dead.
You talk to me around that track, so it's not just gonna happen like that, cause ain't no hollaback girl.
Honestly, you can just copy and paste everything I said about London Bridge for this entry, because all the same principles apply here. I definitely find this song far more actively irritating than most of the other songs in this tier, but I'd definitely be more willing to believe that Hollaback Girl is secretly a masterpiece than most other songs in the first half of this list.
I kissed a girl, but I did.
There are very few songs that are stranger to return to these days than I Kissed a Girl by Katy Perry. I don't think this song is good at all, but I don't dislike it as much as I hold an intense fascination towards it.
It's not what good girls do, not how they should behave.
This song talks about Katy kissing another girl with such an incredible sense of gravitas, like it's treated within the song as this earth-shattering action that she knows is gonna make the jaws of everyone around her hit the floor. She's expecting everyone to be scandalized by the mere idea that she could possibly enjoy kissing another woman. And honestly, listening to a song like that in 2021 is like listening to a flapper bragging about how naughty she is for showing off her ankles. Obviously, we still have a long way to go on the road of LGBT+ rights, but the fact is that the support for gay marriage in the US has increased from 40% when this song came out to 70% today. The climate has shifted so dramatically, so quickly, that this song from 13 years ago sounds like it came from a different eon. I still do think it's a bad song because of both the general ickiness of using lesbian teasing as a prop to get attention, and Katy's overwrought jackhammer singing, which gets very old very quickly, but I do think it's the type of bad song that deserves to be preserved in a museum rather than thrown in the trash. So if you guys noticed that the lyrics in this song are, yeah, a little bit pushy.
You got no choice, babe, but to move on.
Oof, that is a big yikes. Yeah, I don't think these lines are really coming across the way Max Martin intended them to. I mean, I'm sure there are some idiots out there who would be super overdramatic about it and say shit like, oh, this is morally reprehensible, think of the innocent children whose minds are getting corrupted by it, or some dumb shit like that. But nah, it's just a few lines that don't rub me the right way in the classic Max Martin banger. I might think it's bad, but hey, what does my opinion matter anyways, right? Yeah, so remember the Savage Garden bit from earlier where I said the pre-9/11 2000s were essentially just a couple bonus years of the 90s? Yeah, this song is continued evidence for that hypothesis, since the 90s are definitely strong with this one, if the presence of Mariah Carey, 98 Degrees, Joe, and Jammin' Lewis all together on one song didn't tip you off to that. This is the most middling number one hit of the entire decade. I mean, this is, what, the fifth time Mariah tried to remake One Sweet Day? Yeah, I'm not surprised the public took a break from her for a few years after this one.
Is what you had, baby girl, I'm what you had.
And here we have the last of those twinkly love songs where pop princesses pair up with hardcore rappers, and I have to admit that despite the twinkly annoying beat and J-Lo's unusually pitchy performance, it is genuinely really nice to hear her singing about breaking free of her relationship, because as it turns out, LL Cool J is the absolute biggest piece of shit in the world.
It's better when you angry, come in, I'll prove it now, come in.
I mean, I gotta give him credit. I legitimately want to punch this guy squarely in the nose, and it's really cathartic to see J-Lo kick his ass to the curb. Let me rephrase that for you. The best thing about this breakup song is that you end up hating the man so much that you wind up rooting for Jennifer Lopez. Keep in mind, 3 months before this, she put out a song about what a genuine girl next door she was with a music video where she whined that people took her picture as she lounged on a yacht and bought a diamond ring. So, yeah, that's your protagonist in this love song. Have fun rooting for her to win. You know, you'd think a song called Don't Forget About Us, made as a direct follow-up to the single biggest hit song of the entire decade, would have at least one single element in it worth remembering.
She had dumps like a truck, 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 thighs like wah, wah.
So considering that this song is widely agreed to be one of the most ridiculous, sexist, and objectifying pieces of music ever to hit the popular consciousness, you are probably wondering how the hell it wound up all the way up in the meh tier. And the answer to that question is that it's actually not in the meh tier. Because Thong Song is actually great. And it also wasn't a number one hit.
That without you, girl, my life is incomplete.
Yep. That's right, the ridiculous track where a dude sticks out his tongue, humps the air, and declares his undying allegiance to the thong may be the track that everyone remembers, but the slow, mellow, completely indistinct bedroom R&B ballad is the one that actually hit number one. If that isn't a microcosm of the paradoxical quagmire that was the early 2000s pop scene, I don't know what is. One of the more obnoxious record producers of the 2000s was a dude by the name of J.R. Rhoda, whose main gimmick was snatching up any recognizable beat he could get his hands on and sampling them basically unaltered. This is the same guy who made Whatcha Say, Beautiful Girls, and Don't Matter, and while a Rihanna dance song is always going to be preferable to an Akon sour croon, there's still essentially no reason not to listen to the original Tainted Love over this too busy, overstuffed quasi-mashup. Also, apparently J.R. Rhoda looks like this. So, yeah, apparently Rihanna's first number one hit was produced by Robin Thicke tumbled on high for too long.
Doesn't matter what your friends are telling you, doesn't matter what my family's saying to you.
Most of these songs were put in the meh tier because they pick a pretty unengaging middle ground and just stay there all the way through. But of course, the meh tier can also be a good home for songs that have a lot of very strong elements as well as a bunch of shit I can't stand. And Doesn't Really Matter is the primary example of this. On the one hand, you've got the masterful R&B production of Jam and Lewis, who vaulted Janet Jackson into superstardom in the mid-80s and stuck by her side throughout her entire career. But on the other hand, Jam and Lewis really like to experiment, and this particular experiment is very herky-jerky and stuttery in a way that I don't think has aged particularly well. Back on the first hand, you've got Janet's beautiful cooing voice, which is always an absolute joy to hear. But on the other hand, they use that beautiful voice to make this chorus. God, that's gross. If the bad stuff doesn't bother you as much as it did me, you'll probably love this, but as far as I'm concerned, this bag is just about as mixed as they come. I feel like a lot of people these days don't remember what an absolutely massive phenomenon Christina Aguilera was from the moment she first stepped onto the scene. Her debut album in 1999 had 3 number one hits, which for an artist who didn't come from an already famous group is something that's only happened to 6 acts in the history of the charts. Although one of those 6 acts was Milli Vanilli, so yeah, maybe pump the brakes before you hold that up as any grand indicator of quality. Apparently this song was Christina's first hit that she had any real artistic control over. And you can definitely tell, because while her first 2 number one hits were clearly trying to chase trends, this one is 100% Aguilera. By which I mean it's oversung, kind of clunky, and wouldn't sound out of place on Radio Disney. Yeah, if you didn't know, Christina actually started her career on the Disney Channel alongside Britney Spears and Justin Timberlake back in the 90s. But unlike Britney, who was pumping out A-list hits right out of the box, and Justin, who had the good sense to spend a few years getting his TV Y7 sound and Jerry Curls out of his system before going solo, Christina's first few albums still had that Disney Channel sheen to them. It was all just very immature, lightweight, and chipper, and as for the singing...
What a girl wants.
I'm not gonna harp on Christina Aguilera's over-singing, it's a tedious cliche by this point, and while her vocals do sound pretty strained on just about every moment of this song, it's not as bad as it could be, as evidenced by...
What a girl wants, what a girl needs.
Oh boy, this one. Look, I know this song is fondly remembered, and I will grant that for the most part it is a perfectly fine, if also dated, piece of teen pop that I have no issue with, but then... you know... I mean, I like Genie in a Bottle.
No one, no one, no one.
And moving on from oversinging by Christina Aguilera to oversinging by someone who really should know better. Like I've said before, Alicia Keys is an artist who's way less interesting than she is good. When she does her smooth piano R&B Grammy bait shtick, she's untouchable. But basically any time she's made an actual effort to be a pop star who makes pop music, it just has not worked. No One is just this awkward, heavy, galumphing thing where Alicia sounds like she's trying to put out enough volume to fill a concert venue and having a hard time keeping her breath over a beat that sounds like a Yamaha piano preset occasionally punctuated by an electric whoopee cushion. I mean, the song isn't unpalatable, it's fine, but this being Alicia Keys' biggest hit is tragic for everyone, including and especially the people who had to hear it every 5 minutes on the radio in 2008.
Every other word is a huh, yeah, okay. Could it be that you or at the crib with another lady.
You've probably noticed by now that I'm not a big fan of songs that have awkward, jittery, start-stop rhythms to them. They always make me feel like a squirrel when I listen to them.
No, he said that I was doing a thing. Something's going down, that's the way it seems. Shoot me, there is a way, acting strange. Nobody's holding you back from me.
So, yeah, that alone kind of turned me off to this one. Along with the fact that I also really don't like songs that go into excruciatingly long-winded and detailed accusations of cheating. At a certain point, I feel like I'm just sitting in a room while a couple is fighting and just want to melt into my seat. Really, the fact that this song managed to place this high on the list despite compounding two of my biggest pet peeves on top of each other really is a testament to just how good the hook is and how iconic Bay and Crew's presence and delivery are. And what the hell, might as well tackle the other one too.
A moment like this, some people wait a lifetime.
Yeah, not much to say about either of these two. I mean, they're AI singles, all right. AI being short for both American Idol and the artificial intelligence that I assume was used to algorithmically and passionlessly design both of these songs for mass appeal. They're bland, insipid, and faux inspirational, but technically proficient enough that they're not egregious like the others. Really, not worth expending any real thought on at all. I will say that the vocal performance on both of these songs are above average as far as American Idol songs go, but, I mean, duh, they're by Kelly Clarkson and Carrie Underwood. There's a reason these two are the ones who walked away from the show as actual musical superstars. I'll also say that I was gonna put A Moment Like This below Inside Your Heaven originally, but my opinion of it as a composition was raised a bit when I was researching my video on British number one hits, and I found a really beautiful cover performed on the X Factor UK, that being by that year's winner, Leona Lewis. Oh, and speaking of...
You cut me open and I keep bleeding, keep bleeding.
Yeah, this is another song we have Simon Cowell to thank for. I can't exactly say I'm surprised. I mean, the song is probably the single most overplayed thing in the history of pop radio from the time of its release right up to the present day. And so my brain does naturally associate it with the same forcing, bland, inoffensive, mush down our throats corner of the music industry that the Idol franchise fits into. I mean, that's probably not fair to this song. Like I said, Leona Lewis is a great singer, and this song definitely has more interesting musical ideas than most of its ilk. But I'm sorry, the association in my head between this song and shitty staticky car radio is so strong that I can't hear it without my hand instinctively reaching towards where a dial would be if I were driving. I don't know if I've ever heard a number one hit in my life that is worth discussing less than this one, but I will say that it's extremely funny that B2K got a number one hit while the Backstreet Boys never did. If you don't know who B2K are, well, there's not much to know. They're an R&B boy band who are really only notable these days for launching Omarion's solo career. And considering that I'm pretty sure most of you heard the name Omarion and thought I was talking about a constellation, that should give you a general gist of the group's long-term impact. Apparently they must still have some fans though, considering that someone seems to have edited their Wikipedia page praising them for, and I quote, their incredible street credit and fierce defense of all ground they stood on. And I mean, I can see it. After all, their music career was decorated with such hip, legitimate accolades as a Kids' Choice Award for Best Music Group, and a starring role in a movie which is called, and I am not making this up, You Got Served, a film about which Rotten Tomatoes raves. It's about the sort of make-believe dancing that inner-city youth participate in instead of having sex or joining a gang, and just in time for their feature film debut, the enormously popular B2K has disbanded.
Baby, you got it bad.
You know, it makes a little too much sense that one of the absolute biggest hits of the 2000s was based on a true story from a recording session where Usher was literally too horny to work. This is probably the most Usher song that's ever ushered, and maybe that basicness is the reason why I've never been too huge on it. Something's missing, even if I can't put my finger on what.
If I couldn't sleep, could you sleep? Could you paint me better off?
I've always had a bit of a soft spot for Matchbox 20. Rob Thomas's ridiculous over-emoting has always been kind of charming to me, but even I'll admit that he's kind of pushing his luck here. This song sounds like Rob Thomas's tongue is trying to escape his mouth, and the only way for him to keep it in there is to sharply inhale every other line.
Just breaking my skin. You help me, I'm bent. I'm so scared that I'll never get put back together. Keep breaking me in.
Like, boom. Like that, she working that back. I don't know how to act slow motion for me.
If you want to know just what a chokehold mid-tempo R&B love songs had on Billboard in the early 2000s, this is what Juvenile, aka the Back That Ass Up guy, had to do to get an actual hit. I really do wish this song was more interesting, since it was apparently featured artist Soulja Slim's last song, which went to number one after he passed away, but I'm sorry, this is one of the most middle-of-the-road rap hits I've ever heard. So you know what, I'm not even gonna bother to say anything about this, I'm just gonna read the song's Wikipedia article instead. According to Billboard, the song is about sex. They say Wikipedia is not a trustworthy source.
It's about somebody, guess what? It's gonna be me.
And at this point, you've reached about the halfway point of this video, which I have to assume means that you're enjoying it at least somewhat, and if you are, I would really appreciate it if you'd leave this video a like, leave a few comments below, and hit that subscribe button and the bell for notifications of each new upload. Every interaction this video gets helps my channel perform better with the algorithm, and so the more engagement you can give me, the better. And on that same note, here's a fun fact. I have never gotten a dime of ad revenue from YouTube for making these video essays. Because I review copyrighted music, the big music labels claim all my revenue for themselves. And because of that, I'm only able to make these videos thanks to my supporters on Patreon. If every one of you guys watching could give me even just a couple quarters every time I upload, I'd be fully financially set, so I really hope you'll consider subscribing on Patreon. And of course, if you do, there's something in it for you too. For just $1 per video, you'll get your name in the end credits of every video I make, while for $2, or the price of a cup of coffee, every time I upload, you'll get to suggest and vote for what songs I talk about on this channel in my Grab Bag Review series. $5 patrons get to join my Discord server and hang out, talk, and play games with me and a ton of other cool people. $10 patrons get early access to my videos before they premiere, as well as personalized character art at the end credits of every video, which you can see above. And my $20 patrons get to directly pick any song in the world for me to do a guaranteed discussion on in each new episode of Grab Bag Reviews. In addition, every patron in every tier has an equal chance to be selected to give a patron review of the music I talk about in every main series video I make. So let's see what my patrons have to say about some of these number one hits. From MikeRamp72 regarding Crank That.
Crank That by Soulja Boy is probably the single best song that's ever written. I don't know if I'm ever going to do my own like ranking of the number ones of this decade, but if I ever do that, Crank That is going to be number one without competition. It's just such a fun song. You'll hear it at like a wedding and immediately love it. I don't get why anyone could hate Crank That. It's just a bundle of fun. I love every second of it.
From Single Rider Reek regarding I Wanna Fuck You.
With Akon releasing a song like this, it's impossible to take him seriously, even before he did that collaboration with The Lonely Island. Wait, Snoop Dogg is involved? Well, time to grab my popcorn because it's comedy night tonight.
From Roadrunner regarding Girlfriend, this song, despite all the baggage surrounding it, is such a rocker. I think it might be one of the best number ones of the 2000s. Avril does a great job, and the track has so much energy. From 999 regarding Beautiful Girls, what this song did to Stand By Me should be a punishable crime. I hated this song in middle school and still hate it today, and I've got nothing else to say about it. And last but not least, from Zara Music She regarding Crack A Bottle, I'm not actually here to talk about Crack A Bottle. I'm just here to point out the fact that the US public is a bunch of dumbasses for not letting FAC even touch the top 100. Seriously guys, FAC is one of the greatest pieces of art ever created, and fuck the American and British publics for not letting it become the number one hit that it 100% deserved to be. Thank you all for your continued support. I've devoted my life to making these videos for you guys, and that's all thanks to your financial backing. Unfortunately, I've still got a ways to go before I'm fully financially stable, and literally every individual dollar helps more than you could possibly know. Thank you all for allowing me to make content for you. Y'all are the best. And now that we've got all the shilling out of the way, let's move on to the good half of the list.
I can hear your thoughts. I can see your dreams. I don't know how you do what you do. I'm so in love with you.
Well, here we have it, folks. As of 2001, Amazed by Lone Star is the most recent country song to hit number one on the Billboard Hot 100. We've had some country-adjacent stuff like Old Town Road and Timber, and we've had some stuff that's arguably country like Shallow and Inside Your Heaven, but Amazed is the most recent number one hit that is pure, unmistakable, couldn't be anything else in the world, good old-fashioned country music. And I suppose there's a bit of purity in that, considering that this is one of the most basic, by-the-numbers country songs you'll ever hear in your life. Definitely more than a bit boring, but I'd argue at least a bit endearing.
Go live your life.
I think it really says something about the state of hip-hop in 2008 that not only did one of the year's biggest hits directly sample the fucking Numa Numa song, but that sample is far and away the best part of it. It's honestly a legitimately great hook, while the rest of the instrumental is the exact same type of overprocessed robotic twinkle shit T.I. used on Whatever You Like. And as for T.I. himself, well, I mean, based on the song's YouTube comments, it seems like a lot of people do find the song to be legitimately inspirational, which I can only imagine comes from a sense of nostalgia for a time when people put up Hang In There cat posters unironically. Because T.I. raps about his come up in a really obnoxious, condescending tone, talking about how much more he's got figured out than you, including such trite, playdead aspirationalisms as unhappy with the riches because you're piss poor morally, I could do without the fame and rappers today are comedy, and I'm not voting for Hillary because women make rash emotional decisions and I don't want anyone getting nuked. I mean, man, I'm sure that is inspiring to someone.
Said my niggas don't dance, we just pull up our pants and do the rock away.
Kind of fitting that my favorite Scott Storch beat of the 2000s is from the song about doing the world's laziest dance move.
Oh, Jesus Christ! It's getting hot in here, so take off all your clothes.
One of the biggest cultural shifts throughout the 2000s decade was the realization that hip-hop could be more than just gangster rap. And while Kanye tends to carry the banner of this change, I feel like Nelly doesn't deserve to be overlooked in that conversation, because he definitely gave lip service to being a gangster while never managing to convince anyone that he was legit. But that didn't matter, because he was just having too much fun for anyone to care. He was loose, he had a funny accent, he sang his own hooks, and he was the life of the party, with Hot In Here being the definitive example of this, even if I've never loved it personally. It's a bit too repetitive for my taste, and definitely wears out its welcome, even if the core formula it's repeating is definitely a fun one. Alright, so I'm gonna be discussing these next two songs together, and I get this might seem like a weird duo to pair up, and also for that matter a weird duo to have this high on the list, but just hear me out here. Pow by the Black Eyed Peas and Music by Madonna are both songs that I've seen quite a lot of people call among the worst songs of the entire decade. And it's taken me quite a while to realize that I didn't agree with that and to come to terms with why. The fact of the matter is that both of these songs are incredibly annoying when you're not in the mood for them. And frankly, it's kind of hard to imagine a scenario in which you would be in the mood for them. Music has got this really high-pitched, irritating, whining sound that fluctuates up and down throughout it. It sounds like a robot playing a recorder solo, and Madonna's pitch-shifted vocals have become one of the most infamous sounds of the decade for a reason. By a similar token, Boom Boom Pow is the primary song people point to when talking about what hacks the Black Eyed Peas are, just throwing together a million different sonic ideas into a rock tumbler with no care as to what they'll congeal into. I'd argue that I'm a Bee is far more egregious in that regard, but Boom Boom Pow is still just a bunch of narcissists fanning their own egos while making mind-melting noise. At the end of the day, both Music and Boom Boom Pow are horribly embarrassing pieces of grating electro clash which are dated beyond belief, and to be honest, that's kind of why I love them. As much as my better instincts might tell me otherwise, I still do find both of these songs to be kind of adorable in the same way that I find the 2015 scenes from Back to the Future to be adorable. Music and Boom Boom Pow are both completely convinced that they are what the new age of music is going to be. They're both making the statement that the future is now, old man. We're in a new millennium and this is what it's going to sound like. Boom Boom Pow in particular, that song may just be a jumbled mess of incoherent ideas, but it kind of reminds me of scrolling through iTunes on my first iPod Touch, downloading an incoherent mess of apps that literally did everything from a notepad to a photo editor to a TV remote. I mean, yeah, most of those apps objectively sucked, but the novelty of being able to do all this on one device for the first time was something that really stuck with me. To me, Boom Boom Pow is the soundtrack to the moment that our relationship with media changed forever, while Music is the sound of all the most dated sounds of the 90s making a power play at taking control of the 21st century. They're basically the sonic adventure of music, overflowing with so much raw ambition to usher in a new age of the medium that they were almost custom built to age poorly, but that abundance of ambition was emblematic of their time in a way that makes them fascinating time capsules to return to. And I think I'm also going to group these next three entries together, not for reasons anywhere near as profound as the last two, but rather because these next three entries aren't really songs you'll listen to for their own sake. They're more just good songs to have around as cultural artifacts because they're basically more catchphrases than they are songs. Like, take this song, Grills. It's one of the most ridiculous things I've ever heard in my life. I'd rather be dead than be caught listening to it in public, but I just can't help but get a huge smile on my face whenever I hear it. Just the way these guys elevate their stupid tooth jewelry to this almost biblical level of importance and have this woman swoon over it, I just can't get enough of it. It's absolutely wonderfully ludicrous.
Stand up! Stand up!
And on the topic of Ludacris, yeah, this is another one that I'm not really sure how you're supposed to listen to, but it's just a good song to have around. Sometimes you need to tell people to stand up. Same way you sometimes just gotta tell people to get back, motherfucker, or to move, bitch, get out the way. Frankly, I'm surprised that Luda didn't break through in the 90s, considering that his goal seemed to make a career entirely out of catchphrases and charisma. I mean, he was basically the DaBaby of the 2000s in always but one, although thankfully that one difference is a pretty damn important one.
When the pimps in the crib, ma, drop it like it's hot, drop it like it's hot, drop it like it's hot.
And for the last song in this little catchphrase trilogy, I mean, come on, let's be real. When is the last time you've actually gone out of your way to actually listen to the actual Drop It Like It's Hot by Snoop Dogg and Pharrell? You haven't. That just didn't happen. But at the same time, let's be real. How much worse would society be if this song didn't exist within it? It's easy to forget these days that songs like this weren't meant to be listened to in full, but instead were designed to be downloaded as ringtones so you'd get a dope little catchphrase whenever your phone rang. And the chorus was really the only part that people cared about, and the verses were just there for a formality. And the more things change, the more they stay the same, I guess.
Who's gonna take your place? There ain't nobody better. Oh, baby, baby, we belong together.
Okay, so I have to admit, I kind of fucked myself over on this one, because while I used to really like We Belong Together, one day I looked this song up online without realizing that I still had YouTube set to double speed, and... Yeah, it immediately turned into a trashy dance remix of the original that I kind of love, and now I've listened to it at double speed so many times that the original sounds really slow by comparison. That is just a me problem, though, and I can't deny that this is a very sweet, moving song. Nor can I deny that after completely owning the 90s from start to end, Mariah Carey still having enough cultural dominance to produce the single most successful song of the entire 2000s decade is extremely impressive. For perspective, that would be like if Drake got the biggest hit of this decade in 2025. Which, now that I'm saying that out loud, is 100% something that's actually going to happen. I mean, let's be real here. So, what song could I have possibly chosen to put immediately after the single biggest song of the entire decade?
Uh-huh. No, no, no.
You didn't.
You'll bet your sweet pippy I did!
Yeah, this is another one I see shit on a lot, and I get it. Lil Wayne is a pretty gross guy, and hearing him brag about how a girl wants to lick him like a lollipop definitely doesn't sound like the most optimal way of spending my weekend. But I gotta be honest, the lyrics barely even register to me when I listen to this. When I hear lollipop, I just kind of turn my brain off and let the entire thing wash over me as this abstract wave of auto-tune. And if you do that, then it's kind of a vibe, not gonna lie.
Tell me your blue skies fade to gray. Tell me your passion's gone away.
Bad Day by Daniel Powder is an absolute enigma of a song, because I don't think anybody has ever actually gone out of their way to listen to it. I mean, just try and picture a scenario in your head where an actual human being says, oh gee, you know what I really feel like listening to right now? Bad Day by Daniel Powder. I mean, come on, it's pure fiction. You'd be laughed off a Wattpad for saying that. I mean, sure, it was a number one hit, and in fact, it was the biggest hit of 2006, but I'm totally convinced that that was 100% because the radio legally adopted it as its child. And honestly, I think that's kind of what it was meant for. As bizarre as it is to say, there has been more than one occasion where I just had a really awful, shitty day, I was driving home feeling miserable, and then this song came on the radio and reminded me to keep my chin up, take the L, and just do better tomorrow. And you know what? It helped. It really did. If you actively seek out this song when you're feeling down, then listening to it just makes you feel defeatist and pathetic. But if you hear this song out in the wild when you're feeling down, it feels like the universe has given you a hearty pat on the back. It doesn't really have any use to anyone outside of that specific context, but hey, at least that's something.
Never made it as a wise man. I couldn't cut it as a poor man stealing.
I feel like most people these days would probably agree that Nickelback got a bit too much hate back in the day if you pressed them on it, but at the same time, let's be real, their name didn't become synonymous with shitty music for no reason. Out of all the ugly, sludgy, post-grunge butt rock that clogged up the airwaves in the 2000s, Nickelback songs were by far the most ubiquitous, and while I'm too young to remember it personally, the idea of this song and 1,000 uninspired clones of it blaring out of radios everywhere I went for years on end is an absolutely miserable thought. That being said, I don't think it's inherently bad to have a few songs that sound like that around as long as they're only played in moderation. And now that we're not living in that time period, I can appreciate this song out of context for the basic yet emotionally effective song it is. Ah yes, Independent Women Part 1 by Destiny's Child, one of the least unfeminist things I've ever heard in my life. Admittedly, this one is more than a bit cheesy to come back to these days. I mean, its message is literally, I am a strong independent woman who don't need no man. And of course, it's from the soundtrack to this fucking film, so it also has to have a product placement about the movie in it, with the Charlie's Angels references crammed in about as gracefully as your average Raid Shadow Legends ad.
Girl, I didn't know you could get down like that. Charlie, how your angels get down like that.
So, yeah, this is the same kind of corny pop feminism as Stupid Girls and All About That Bass that was almost designed to age awkwardly. But hey, it is much better than both of those songs, and it's definitely better than Beyonce's other big call and respond girl power anthem.
Get busy, just hear that booty nonstop when the beat drop, just keep swinging it, get jiggy.
I'll be honest, I don't have a lot to say about Get Busy as a song. It's about as straightforward a dancehall track as you can get. But as I was researching, I learned that apparently one of Get Busy's most notable legacies is being the biggest hit to use something called the Diwali rhythm. To make a very long story short, a rhythm, which is Jamaican patois for rhythm, is a type of repeating musical phrase made of any combination of a song's percussion, rhythmic, and bass sections. Essentially, because copyright laws in Jamaica were so relaxed for so long, a culture developed there where a popular song's bass line and percussion essentially became owned by the collective culture rather than the individual who made them, with those distinctive rhythmic bars becoming a rhythm that anybody could use, and it became a show of pride and skill to be able to take a popular rhythm and make it your own. In 2002, a musical phrase known as the Diwali rhythm became popular, and that was the rhythm that spread beyond Jamaica and turned dancehall into a worldwide phenomenon. The Diwali rhythm is most notable for its Indian-style swing and syncopated clapping, and it's been responsible for some of the biggest dancehall hits of all time, including Get Busy.
In the club, them won't flex with us. To get next to us, them not vex with us.
And also this big hit from the same year. And then, a few years later, so yeah, all of these different songs, all huge hits, and all made from a rhythm owned by a culture rather than just one person. That is fucking dope. And unfortunately, I don't have any fascinating lessons in world history to go with this one. All I have to say is that it's a cute little pop rap song that I'm honestly surprised Nelly was able to pull off as well as he was. Okay, how much you want to bet that that line was originally Baby, I Love You, and then Nelly just slipped her a 20 to sing his name in there instead?
And now that you're gone, just wanna be with you.
Out of all the songs that went to number one this decade, this is the one that I understand the least. I mean, pretty much all the other number one hits that I have no memory of, I could at least wrap my head around. They were from huge names, or they had memorable hooks, or they were tied into trends that I could see sweeping them to the top. Be With You is a late release single from Enrique Iglesias' breakthrough album, which had already had a number one hit the year before, but that was riding off the big Latin boom, whereas this is just a catchy but thoroughly unremarkable house song that sounds about 3 years behind the times. I mean, I certainly don't dislike it, but I just can't believe that this was the Enrique song that topped the charts and not I Like It or Escape. I mean, hell, this song did better numbers than Hero did in 2002. Think about that.
And I was all you had.
This one, on the other hand, nah, this one's an absolute classic, as synonymous with the early 2000s as they come. I've personally never been a huge fan of it. Everything about it is really pretty, but it doesn't really move anywhere. It just kind of floats in place for 4 minutes, but I can certainly see the appeal.
I can have another you in a minute. Matter of fact, he'll be here in a minute.
And here we have it. Beyonce's biggest hit ever is one where she tells a man that he is meaningless to her and she could find a new boy toy at the snap of the fingers because she's literally Beyonce. And frankly, if a song with that topic hadn't been Beyonce's biggest hit, then I think something would have been just a little bit off with the universe. I guess it is a little strange that Queen Bee's biggest hit is just a fairly normal pop song rather than some big grand statement piece like she's known for these days. But hey, at least it's an iconic normal pop song.
Well, I'm on the way to time, Cole, I wanna be keeping you warm.
And here we've got Sean Paul's other big solo hit, this one also using a popular rhythm from Jamaica called the applause rhythm, which you probably won't recognize from anything else, but which has been used by countless other reggae and dancehall stars, including Sizzla, Beanie Man, and Vybz Kartel. And not much else to say, really. It's a solid dancehall track. Enough said.
Fill up my cup,
drink,
mazel
tov.
Right.
1, 2, 3.
suppose this song does deserve mention as the first song in Billboard history to debut at number one purely organically and not because of either industry radio manipulation or American Idol. But frankly, I find it kind of hard to remember this song as anything more than a pretty standard late period Britney Spears song, with quite possibly the most awkward euphemism for a three-way I've ever heard. I mean, who knows? She's playing it so cutesy and coy that maybe the song isn't even about having a three-way. My personal headcanon is that the song is actually just about Britney Spears having sex with Fergie, and the three P's refers to Britney's pussy and Fergie's two penises, which she does have if you didn't know.
I'll be spreading my wings.
See?
Shorty, you're my angel, you're my darling.
Hindsight, it's absolutely hysterical to me that the Mr. Boombastic guy of all fucking people managed to come back out of nowhere 6 years later with the biggest album of the year and two massive number one singles. And it's somehow even funnier that he spends both of them doing a distressingly accurate Dr. Zoidberg impression.
Looking back, shorty, always I mention, say me not giving her much attention.
God, imagine the alternate universe where that played over the opening of Deadpool.
It's all good when you live for your beer fun, can't be a son, what about the long run?
Every little thing I do never seems enough for you.
It's Gonna Be Me by NSYNC is an iconic piece of the early 2000s, and the only song from the notorious TRL boy band Wars to hit number one on the Hot 100. It's as classic as vintage Max Martin can possibly get, and yeah, it may be held back a bit by some questionable lyrical choices, and I argue that Bye 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 did this song's job better overall, but I could still say with some confidence that there's a reason this song is so well remembered to this day. Actually, no, just kidding, NSYNC are embarrassing flops and Backstreet outsold, cry about it. Glamorous is a song with a lot of very annoying elements in it that is absolutely carried by its stunningly gorgeous production and arrangement. This song sounds like a flight over a gorgeous nightlit city in your own private G5. This producer needs more work, although that producer is also the guy responsible for Nicki Minaj's Anaconda, and literally the only non-music related fact on his Wikipedia page is that Donald Trump once gave him a shout-out. None of that lowered this song's placement on this ranking, but what did lower it was a really out of place ludicrous verse, and Fergie unfortunately turning her Ferginess up to 11. I almost dropped this one down a tier purely for how incredibly ratchet Fergie is being here. And yes, I do in fact deserve to be thrown off a cliff for using the word ratchet. Thank you for noticing. I really do like this song. I think it does a great job setting a low-key, calm city night atmosphere, which Carlos then absolutely tears through with his beautiful crying guitar line. Not gonna lie though, I am a bit bitter that this became by far Santana's most viewed music video after an influx of new views in 2017 once Wild Thoughts dropped, because I'll be damned if one of the greatest rock bands of all time got their most viewed video thanks to a DJ Khaled song with the line "fuck you till you're burned out cremation" in it.
And I'm so sick of love songs, so tired of tears.
Pretty astounding to me how Neo can be such a gifted singer-songwriter with so much personality and yet so little presence as an artist in his own music. He's like Usher if he were really into poetry slams. Also, it makes me very happy that a song about hating the radio became one of the biggest radio hits of the decade.
Come my lady, come my lady, you're my butterfly, sugar.
Fun fact, this is the only nu metal song ever to hit number one on the Hot 100. Yeah, in case any of you scene kids from back there are listening to this now, Korn, Slipknot, Limp Bizkit, and Papa Roach never got close to sniffing the top of the charts, but the Come My Lady, Come My Lady guys got there no problem at all. I mean, what were all those phonies thinking back then, right? I don't know how anyone could possibly prefer some pussy-ass pop song built on some pretty little RHCP sample over the glorious, timeless majesty of chocolate starfish and the hot dog flavored water. So here's yet another fun fact. Right Round is apparently Dillard's best-selling song of all time. Yeah, this song actually managed to move more copies than Low, which is pretty astonishing to me because I didn't think it was possible for literally any piece of entertainment ever to move more copies than Low did in 2008, let alone Dillard's much-maligned follow-up. Trust me, I get where the hate is coming from. This song is absolutely insufferable if you're not in the mood for a head-spinning party. But I'm sorry, the amount of fun I've had singing along with this song when I am in the mood to let loose and go stupid stupid makes it easily worth the price of admission for me. Also, this is not only the song that got Kesha's foot in the door, but Dr. Luke told her that it was in her best interest to be credited on this song and appear in the music video, and she told him, no, fuck that, if I'm gonna make a name for myself, I'm doing it my way. But realistically, this song deserves adulation for that reason alone. Here's another fun fact for you. Umbrella by Rihanna was one of the longest running number one hits of the decade in several countries. And in a good number of those countries, this song's run at number one was punctuated by record rainfall and flooding. New Zealand saw a month-long typhoon that ended at almost the exact time Umbrella left the top 10. The song's success in Romania coincided with massive downpours ending a devastating drought. And the song's 8-week run on top in the UK saw some of the worst rainfall and flooding in British history, with the media even going so far as to dub it the Rihanna curse. It seems that even God himself seems to believe this song was divinely inspired, which makes me feel ever more alone in thinking that this song is just barely above okay. I mean, I certainly do respect this song for turning Rihanna into the pop culture icon she indisputably deserved to be, but frankly, I've always found her vocals to be fairly unspectacular in a way that really isn't that well suited for straightforward, silly love songs. I think that pretty much all of those songs of hers from the early 2010s where she was exploring her BDSM kink aren't as good as Umbrella on the basis of production alone. I still found Rihanna herself to be a much more engaging presence on all of them because they actually gave her something interesting to talk about. I don't know when Rihanna's finally gonna put out that next album, but when she does, I hope that she swings big and takes risks because that's where she shines the brightest. You don't know how badly I miss this. I so desperately wish we could go back to an era where the biggest hit in the United States had a picture on its Wikipedia page of its singer playing a transparent piano next to an ice sculpture with a giant codpiece wearing a dress made out of bubbles. I could go on about what a lightning bolt of energy Lady Gaga sent through the late 2000s club scene, and how she's still the quintessential image of what comes to my head when I hear the words pop star. But instead, there's something about this song that we have to talk about. So you guys all know that chorus, right? It's one of the most iconic choruses of the entire 2000s decade, right? Yeah, well, the thing is, that's not actually what she's saying. No, I'm not kidding. That is apparently actually what she was saying this entire time. Trust me, I've looked it up, I've cross-referenced it with official sources, those are the official lyrics of the song, and they played it completely uncensored on the radio all the time. I used to sing along with this song on the radio in middle school. Hell, everybody did. Lady Gaga made an anthem to throat fucking go to number one, and nobody noticed. And I mean, literally nobody noticed. Pop, 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 poker face, pop, pop, poker face, nah, 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 nah. Yeah. Not even South Park managed to catch that. Eric Cartman's cover of Poker Face is officially cleaner than the version they played on the radio next to Daughtry and Alicia Keys. So what is everything great about Pink as an artist all rolled up into one song? She's got the general demeanor and energy of your aunt with a lot of regrettable tattoos who calmed down after raising her kid but still talks like she's 10 years younger than she is. And she takes that image and completely fucking owns it. She's a rock star, she's got her rock moves, and she sure as hell don't need you tonight. If you don't like this song even a little bit, then stay the hell away from Pink's back catalog. You are not gonna like what you find there. Check my flow. Cause we belong. I think this song teaches us a very valuable lesson that we should all carry with us throughout our lives. And that's that if you're gonna totally sell out, it's best to have Max Martin as your producer. Okay, I'm gonna be totally honest with you. When I was a kid, I thought this was a Lady Gaga song. Yeah, go ahead, laugh at me all you want to. But really, just listen to this and tell me you don't see where 12-year-old me was coming from. Dirty babe, you see these shackles, baby, I'm your slave. I'll let you whip me if I misbehave. It's just that no one makes me feel this way. Sexy Back is the song that made Justin Timberlake the male pop star of the 2000s. The female side of that race stayed competitive the whole way through, but Justin kinda just won the entire thing with one fell swoop. He looked America dead in the eye, said, "I don't care how weird this sounds, this is your new favorite song now," and we fucking listened to him. It's a song that I'm sure I would have hated if I were doing this back in the day, considering how many people tried and utterly failed to replicate what it was going for, and if it had more of a direct long-term impact on the direction of music, I might be singing a different tune, but Sexy Back is a song that I'm totally cool with having exactly one of around. This seems to be one that a lot of people have turned on over the years, so putting it in the good tier might not be as much of a crowd pleaser as it once was, but if it makes you feel any better, this is technically my least favorite of Justin's solo number ones, just barely getting beaten out by...
Is this the way it's really going down? Is this how we say goodbye?
I think this is the only number one I've ever seen where the shortened radio version is more than 5 minutes long. I mean, hell, even American Pie only barely broke four. Honestly, though, I'm totally cool with the length. Timbaland has created such a tranquil, contemplative atmosphere here that I really don't mind staying in it for a good long while. Although, yeah, I am perfectly happy to clock out as soon as that runtime is up. The song is also a textbook example of a really cool musical technique known as text painting, which is where the composition of the music matches up with the words being said over it for a really cool immersive effect. Notice how the chorus slowly trickles down the octave, only to subtly and naturally jump right back up to the top of that octave on the words "back around."
Hey there, Delilah, what's it like in New York City? I'm 1,000 miles away, but girl, tonight you look so pretty, yes you do.
The more I look at this song, the more astounded I am that this was a number one hit. 2007 was the year where music production was the densest and busiest that it's ever been, with Timbaland, Kanye West, and T-Pain dominating the country with these absolute massive steamrollers of audio, and then nested right in the middle of all those, you've got some guy singing an acoustic love song about a girl he met at a party once, and it somehow managed to slice through the fog and become a beloved classic. What was so special about this simple little song that it managed to strike such a chord with the people of the US? I mean, do you have any explanation, lead singer of the Plain White Tees, Tom Higginson?
Hey, what's up, Sean? It's Tom from Plain White Tees. You asked why I think Hey There Delilah struck, you know, such a chord with people and connected with so many people. Like, why was that the song out of all the songs I've written? I wish I knew, because then I would try to replicate that every time, you know? You know, it's so funny. I would have said the lyrics, because the lyrics tell such a unique and kind of intricate story. And you really get the feeling that it's a true story and, you know, about a real person. Because I think the song piques the curiosity of people because it does sound so authentic with all the details and stuff. But it's so funny, just the other day, I did an interview with somebody that was from Italy, and they were talking about that song, and they said they remember the first time hearing that song, it brought them to tears, but they didn't understand English. So they didn't even know what I was saying in the song, but hearing the song still brought them to tears. So that when, there goes my theory about the lyrics, you know? I don't know exactly what it is about that song. It was just kind of the, I guess like the lightning in a bottle, you know? It had a nice, beautiful melody, very simple vibe to it. The production is nice and stripped down, so it doesn't sound dated. It's not gonna go out of style anytime soon because it's just like a guitar and a vocal. The lyrics are, you know, pretty well crafted and tell a nice story that I think people can relate to. So yeah, I don't know, I guess all the above, just throw all that into a pot and mix it up and you get Hey There Delilah. So awesome question, and believe me, every time I write a song, I'm putting just as much effort in and I'm trying just as hard to tell a story and connect, but for whatever reason, they don't all quite get to that level. I'm very thankful that Delilah did connect at that level, and it did get so big. So anyway, thank you for your question. Thanks for loving the band and the song, and hope to see you around.
So baby, don't worry, you are my only, you won't be lonely, even if the sky is falling down.
Down by Jay Sean is the best kind of pop song, the kind that's never gonna blow your mind, but it just puts you in a good mood, and you can play it over and over again without ever getting sick of it. Also, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that this song was actually one of the first smash hits ever on YouTube, being the most viewed music video on the site in its first 2 weeks after launch, which meant that just 5 months in, this song had accumulated a grand total of 5 million views. So, yeah, apparently in 2009 you could have the biggest song on YouTube by accumulating 2 me's worth of views, which is honestly kind of adorable. And here we've got another interesting curio in chart history. I don't have much to say about the song. Aaliyah definitely deserved to hit number one at least once in her tragically short life, and this song would probably be a bit higher if Timbaland's low buzzing production were a bit cleaner. But what interests me most about Try Again is that it was the first song ever to hit number one on the Hot 100 without being available for purchase at all. It did eventually get a physical release on CD and vinyl, but that wasn't until after it hit number one, and since this was an era where the Hot 100 didn't count any digital sales for the charts at all, that meant that Try Again was able to hit number one entirely because of how much play it was getting on the radio. I actually found an article in Billboard magazine about this from the time, and it's very clear that this rubbed them the wrong way. They were being really defensive about it. The line that stands out most to me is, and I quote, "We are constantly examining the ratio of airplay to sales on the charts, and if we find that the current decrease in the singles market is more than a lull, we will once again make adjustments to ensure a properly balanced chart." Good God, that wall has so much writing on it, you'd think Billboard was based in Berlin. This song's an eternal bop for men, women, and everyone in between. And if you disagree with that, well, then I guess you're just not ready for all of this jelly. Ever since Old Town Road, Billboard's rules have really incentivized artists to create remixes of their popular songs, since the success of an original song plus all of its remixes are all counted together in one spot, and most modern artists take advantage of this by just slapping on an extra guest verse or releasing a slightly extended cut without changing anything else. It's genuinely really refreshing to look back and see a remix hit number one that's an actual honest-to-God remix, where they took a decent but wholly unspectacular R&B song, chopped it up into pieces, and then put those pieces back together into this really cool high-tempo hip-hop fusion banger. I've talked a lot of shit about songs that have stuttering stop-start beats, but this is how you do it right. This one keeps the energy up and moving the whole time to create an end product that's an absolute blast to listen to. Now, man, full disclosure, I was originally planning on getting a cameo from Mystical here to talk about this remix, but yeah, I've already got 2 videos with Drake Bell cameos that have aged really poorly. No need to pour more fuel onto that fire. Here you have it, folks. The one singular 50 Cent song that actually manages to justify its own existence. Okay, I guess PIMP also wasn't bad. Oh yeah, and Disco Inferno, that one was good too. Okay, 50 Cent had his moments. But we can agree that this one blows all the rest of them out of the water, yeah? I mean, granted, I don't think it was particularly hard for him. When Dr. Dre gives you a beat this hot, you'd have to be actively trying to fuck it up. But then again, Out of Control also has a white-hot Dre beat that 50 manages to drain all the life and fun out of. So, hey, let's not look a gift horse in the mouth and take this eternal birthday jam for what it is. I don't know what to do, but to keep part two of my confession. Some songs are good because they speak to the deep emotional depths of your soul. Some songs are good because they have absolutely legendary music that draws you back in time and time again. And then there are songs that are good because it's utterly impossible to tear your eyes away from them no matter how hard you try. The kind of song that when you hear it start, you know you have no choice but to listen through to the end. I maintain that the best big hit of this type I've ever heard is Don't by Ed Sheeran, where he shares way too much information about his turbulent relationship with Ellie Goulding, and you're just sat there in disbelief trying to process why the hell he's telling this stuff to the world. I don't think Confessions Part 2 is quite that endearing because A, this story about getting your side chick pregnant is not actually something that happened to Usher, B, he's coming at this from a far less sympathetic perspective than Ed, and C, this line right here. I hope you can accept the fact that I'm man enough to tell you this. Oh, well, I'll definitely think about that, Usher, and while I'm pondering, please, feel free to sit down on this new chair I got just for you. If I'm gonna tell it, then I gotta tell it all. But yeah, nitpicks aside, it's pretty hard to hate this song. I might not want to return to it particularly often, but whenever I do hear it, for the next 4 minutes, Usher has got a captive audience. And that is a surprisingly rare trait for a number one hit to have. Too many days, so many hours, I'm still burning to your return. And the same principle applies to Usher's massive cry of anguish and regret from the same album. A little bit too extra for me to want to seek it out too often, but when it hits, holy damn, does it hit. She says she wants some Marvin Gaye, some Luther Vandross, a little Anita, but definitely set this party alright. This song is absolutely ridiculous and, in all honesty, probably should not exist. I mean, this song came about because Jamie Foxx started throwing parties and inviting as many big-name musicians as he could find, literally just so he could hopefully rub elbows with the right one to break him out of acting and into a music career. And he just so happened to get lucky enough to run into a jaw-wired Kanye West at the absolute perfect time, with Twista getting thrown into the mix purely because Atlantic was doing him a favor by taking him back after years of flopped albums and insisted that he needed a single. This song is three men, all desperate in very different ways, all being thrown into a cement mixer and hoping something good would somehow come out the other side, and somehow it totally worked. Kanye's Chipmunk Soul production is some of the best I've ever heard, Fox's hook is iconic as hell, and Twista.
You ready for the world, girl? Come and come with me, I touch you all over your body, baby, don't say no to me, and never know to be controlling me, I'm loving the way you be holding me, but I'll be missing in the jealousy.
He's fucking twisted, enough said. This is one of the most singular and wonderful R&B jams of the decade, which easily could have gone into the excellent tier if it weren't for...
Got a light-skinned friend, look like Michael Jackson. Got a dark-skinned friend, look like Michael Jackson.
I gotta say, Kanye, you have done a lot of things over the years that have absolutely knocked me off my feet. But this time, I kinda feel the need to check to make sure you're okay, considering that I'm pretty sure you must have just gotten knocked off your feet by the overwhelming stench of the rotting, long-dead fish in that barrel you were shooting at by making a joke like that in 2004.
Man, I swear she fine, home. Why she always lying, oh.
Yeah, Kanye's verse is a bit too awkward and goofy for his own good, which does bring the song down. On top of that skin color joke, which probably wouldn't fly particularly well today. But hey, at least we all know that Kanye West would always take care to be more thoughtful and deft-handed when commenting on topics of race moving forward.
The destruction of the spirit of the people of southern Louisiana and Mississippi may end up being the most tragic loss of all.
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
I'm from the Empire State. That's
And from one half of the throne to the other, we've got this all-time classic ode to the city of lights, sounds, and apparently a serious issue with garbage collection. This was the last number one hit of the 2000s decade, and I don't know if there was a better way to close off these 10 years than with a team-up between Jay-Z and Alicia Keys making the New York anthem to end all New York anthems. One final, beautiful swan song for East Coast hip-hop before mainstream rap got drowned in a tidal wave of cotton candy for the next few years.
You remind me of a girl that
Usher is the king of taking massive L's and making them sound fantastic, almost as much as he's the king of replacing pronouns in song titles with the first letter of his own name. This is definitely a highlight of Jam and Lewis's later production work, and I have to say, it's a really nice change of pace to hear a song about a relationship where no one did anything wrong, it just didn't work out because one person had some baggage they couldn't get past. That's a thing that happens sometimes, and while it takes a lot of care to make a song like that and have it be fun to listen to, this song is a testament to just what a classic you can end up with when those efforts go right. This is the hook of the decade. I don't know how that's even disputable. To this day, I still can't bite into an apple without imagining a mouthful of boot fur. And while I totally empathize with people who got sick to death of it back in the day, I don't know how anyone with a soul could reasonably have anything but affection for the song these days. Oh, and one other thing, the credit for bringing the triplet flow into popularity all tends to go to Migos, but, funny thing about that.
That's what I told her, her legs on my shoulder, I knew it was over, that Henny and Cola. Got the house with my swagger, hop in that whip, yo, I got places to.
That's right, years before Versace was even a twinkle in Offset's eye, one man busted out the triplet flow and used it to get the biggest rap songs of both 2008 and 2009. So I think it's high time that we all recognize the true king and give him the respect he deserves. All hail Dillard, god of the triplet.
Baby,
God, did we not deserve Timbaland? I don't know what he was on in the second half of the 2000s, but he managed to create some of the coolest progressions of sounds I've ever heard in my life with clockwork regularity. Apparently, Timbo created this entire song in one two-hour burst of inspiration, and yeah, considering that I locked myself in a cabin in Maine for 3 weeks just to get the script to this stupid video done, that is kind of absurd. Also, it was genuinely really nice to hear T.I. on a number one hit that isn't totally embarrassing. I'd say his part here is honestly one of the highlights, although considering that being on a pop crossover this huge was probably what led him to do what he did in 2008. Yeah, not sure the net gain worked out in our favor on that one. Crazy in Love is a stone-cold classic, easily the crowning achievement of Beyoncé's pop career and one of the most propulsive, fun, and likable hit songs of the entire decade. You wanna know what Crazy in Love isn't? The 16th best song ever made, on a list where numbers 19, 18, and 17 were Imagine, Purple Rain, and Bohemian Rhapsody. Seriously, the fuck were you guys smoking over there?
Okay, get your kids, but then they got their friends. I put up in the bins, they all got a bin.
So here's some trivia for you. Gold Digger is officially the biggest hit in Billboard history that has the N-word in it. And honestly, I'm pretty happy about that, considering that it uses the word as the basis for one of the most iconic rhymes of the entire decade.
I ain't saying she a gold digger, but she ain't messing with no broke niggas.
And really, that's the main appeal of the song. Aside from being just another absolute classic banger from Kanye's early years, as long as this world is filled with gold diggers, or really anyone who makes you feel like you've been played for a chump, this song is gonna have an audience. Seriously, everybody loves this song. I mean, just look at how many results you get when you look up Gold Digger on YouTube. Okay, that is not a rabbit hole that I'm going to go down. I have a feeling that anything I would find down that rabbit hole would be unpleasantly sticky. This is one of those songs I've heard on the radio so many times that it's really easy to forget just how genuinely moving, heartfelt, and beautiful it is. This song is will.i.am's crowning achievement as a producer, specifically because it sounds so completely different from anything else he's ever done. Kind of makes me wonder what he might have been capable of if he had just dropped the whole electroclash hip-hop shtick and just went full pop. This is an absolutely insane but still endlessly bangable jam, made as the theme song to Bad Boys 2 by Nelly, some third guy, and P. Diddy, in that order. This is one of those audio Katamari songs where it just feels like they rolled up every insane musical idea they had all into a blender and refused to cut out anything as long as it kept the energy high. I've always had a real soft spot for these songs that just go as stupid and hard as possible. Also, this song contains quite possibly the quickest swerve I've ever heard in the history of pickup tactics.
Yo, I'm the big booty type, I like them thick with they mind right. Bang it personality, conversate when the time right.
Yeah, good catch there, my dude. And of course, who can forget?
Is the jazz or your mama have reindeer?
Honestly, at worst, that line is so bad it's good, and at best, that line deserves an award for giving us the single greatest lyrics genius annotation of all time.
But I know y'all wanted that 808. Can you feel that bass?
I find it absolutely wonderful that Outkast's compromise once they got sick of working together was just to have both Andre and Big Boy make their own completely separate albums and just gracelessly staple them together. And it's even more wonderful that both artists' individual lead singles instantly became the top two songs in the country. Not just any track could go toe-to-toe with Hey Ya for months on end, but The Way You Move ended up holding its own and even passing it at the last possible moment. Just makes me all the more sad at how overshadowed this song has been by Hey Ya in the years since then. When this song's most notable place in pop culture in recent years has been as a band-aid with Adam Levine's face on it over the sponge-shaped hole in our hearts, something's not right. You know, sometimes I forget that Rihanna once remade one of the most iconic pop songs of all time and did it twice as well. Don't get me wrong, I love Thriller, but as a composition, I feel like it's honestly a little bit too bloated. There's a great underlying pop song in there, but you've really got to dig through a lot of unnecessary filler to get to it. Disturbia is Thriller with the fat trimmed, being sleek, enrapturing, and captivatingly chilly. I'll take this as my go-to Halloween gem anytime. But then again, it is entirely possible that I only feel this way because I'm never going to be able to take Thriller seriously again after my worst hit songs of 1983 video.
Aw, come on, zombies. I know you want this girl too. But she's mine. Oh yes, the doggone girl is.
Oh god, they're attacking.
I'm a real producer and you just a piano man. Your song don't top the charts. I heard them come out of bed.
I absolutely love everything about this song. I love that Timbaland made a song entirely devoted to how the guy who made Candy Shop sucks at making music. I love that he grabbed Nelly and Justin and told them to pick random fights about nothing purely just so he would have some friends to bitch next to. And I love that a song born from such legendary levels of pettiness and starfuckery still managed to hit number one on pure charisma alone. This might not be the best song of the decade, but it is, indisputably, the biggest dub of the decade. Behold, Maroon 5. 1975's Lightning in a Bottle. I definitely don't have a lot of good things to say about this band, but makes me wonder is the same masterclass in funky genre-blending dance pop that it always was. It still blows my mind that critics back in the day referred to this song as so bland that it hurts. I can only imagine those critics must have melted into a puddle of pulsating goo when Girls Like You came out. Frankly, my best assumption is that those critics back then weren't listening to the actual song, but instead they accidentally listened to the Stargate remix. You know, the one with Mims on it.
Gotta pick it up, drop it down, we'll slow over that while she's upside down on the pole.
Oh yeah, remember like an hour and a half ago when I said This Is Why I'm Hot isn't the last we'd be seeing of Mims? That's because, technically speaking, Mims was on a second number one hit, rapping literally four lines for the intro of this official Makes Me Wonder remix and then disappearing forever. And you know the best part? Mims' verse is probably the highlight of this remix.
I've been here before. One day I'll wake up and it won't hurt anymore.
You know, I never thought I'd say this, but I am genuinely glad that we have a Space Force now because someone needs to go up there and close that Stargate.
Man, I've been waiting all night, man. That's how long I've been on ya.
I still can't believe that Kanye West was, like, an actual pop star in the 2000s. He wasn't just some omnipotent deity in an overpriced white t-shirt looking down upon us mere mortals while occasionally bestowing unto us a new project with the sole purpose of ruining Twitter for a few weeks. No, he was just a normal A-list pop star who would drop his albums, promote his singles, and get big crossover hits off of them. Hell, there was actually a bit of competition between Kanye and 50 Cent when both of their albums dropped on the same day, leading to a huge competition between their fans for higher numbers. Of course, Kanye ended up winning that war in both the long and the short term, getting himself a number one album that's widely considered to be among the greatest ever made, with Stronger being the crowning achievement of the whole affair. I guess I don't really have anything else to say about it except F.
He's everything you want. He's everything you need.
I don't think this one is particularly well remembered these days, but that's a damn shame. It's easily one of my favorite post-grunge songs of all time, and one of the only songs about being stuck in the friend zone I've ever heard that actually manages to justify its own existence. As it turns out, the key to doing a friend zone anthem right is to just revel in the tension and frustration of the whole situation, as opposed to the strategy I see most often, which is to just walk up to a girl and say, "Is your boyfriend being abusive? Well, come sit on my dick, that'll solve it." Also, this isn't the first song I've heard that uses that cool reverse guitar effect, but that is easily one of my favorite production gimmicks of all time. More people do that, please.
And you don't know.
Remember that time Janet Jackson's career was murdered dead in its tracks because her nipple got exposed on live TV for half a second by a guy whose career only got bigger from that incident and who was invited back to the Super Bowl years later to perform a tribute to a dead man he had shit-talked several times? Well, at least we have this one really astounding song as her last number one hit to remind us what we lost by being such a society of sexist assholes.
I'm on tonight, you know my hips don't lie, and I'm starting to feel you, boy.
I legitimately don't think there is a single person on the planet who dislikes Hips Don't Lie. This is just everybody's jam. I don't think the radio station has ever been changed when this song came on it. Seriously, if you somehow legitimately dislike this song, leave a detailed comment explaining why, and I'll be sure to let a conservationist know about you, because endangered species really do deserve all the protection we can give them.
Oh boy, I can see your body moving, half animal, half man.
People act like Shakira's furry kink came out of nowhere. I kind of respect the hell out of this song, not gonna lie. It was a genuinely really cool idea to have a song where the entire thing is one guy acting like a piece of shit, and then another guy giving him advice for how to deal with his situation that's so out of this world terrible that by the end, the first guy is just like, "Dude, what the hell is wrong with you? Get the fuck out of here with that crap. I'm just gonna grow a pair and go apologize for being such a dipshit." It's like the song kept on lowering its score over and over again, deep into the negative numbers, and then multiplied by negative one at the last possible minute. It's absolutely glorious.
They see me rolling, they hating, but
trolling and trying to catch me riding dirty.
Lowe may have the hook of the decade, but Ryden absolutely has the beat of the decade. Not necessarily the best beat of the decade, but the beat of the decade. Admittedly, the lyrics are a little bit clunky. It sells itself as a song about how the cops are racially profiling him, but then also goes on to brag about all the warrants out for his arrest. I probably wouldn't do both of those back-to-back if I were him, but hey, clearly it worked out, considering that he made a metric buttload of money from this song, which he apparently invested very wisely, and nowadays, I shit you not, the man is a tech mogul who is worth literal chameleons, with huge paybacks from a few very wise venture capital investments, including, and I shit you not, Maker fucking Studios. So, yeah, for a few years there, the Ryden Dirty guy legally owned the careers of JonTron, Toby Turner, Bart Baker, and Markiplier, among many, many others. I actually have quite a lot to say about this one, but I think I'm going to save most of my thoughts on it for my Best Hit Songs of 2001 video, whenever Ethan and I get around to making that. So for now, I think I'll just leave the talking to someone who was actually there at the time. Take it away, Maya.
Hi, Sean Fay-Wolfe. It's Maya here, and I got your inquiry and question. Question is, tell me how you got involved in making Lady Marmalade and what it was like to work on it. Well, at the time, I was an Interscope artist, Interscope being the major label. While I was on the road, I was in New York City, I got a call from management, and they asked me about being interested in a song that included the ladies. I think maybe one or two weren't necessarily on there just yet, but it sounded pretty cool to me, especially being that I'd worked with so many rappers and male singers in my career, so to get to work with some ladies would be pretty cool, I thought. Interscope was also the distributor of that actual soundtrack when soundtracks were huge, a big thing back then. That was actually the lead single for Moulin Rouge, the movie, and it just so happened that the label that I was on was distributing the project, so they thought of me being one of their only female artists at the time, and I gave it a go. And the rest is history. It was so fun working with the beautiful ladies. And we were all so different, but brought some sauce of our own to the table. I would love to do it again. This year marks the 20th anniversary of Lady Marmalade, but the queen herself, Miss Patty, is responsible for the original hit. So much love to all of the ladies. And it was such an honor to work with everyone and, you know, be a part of something historic. Lots of fun, too.
So grab somebody and get your ass on the dance floor.
Let's get it proper on the funnel.
Most party songs are pretty straightforward and basic, making you move just for the hell of it, and at a glance, Family Affair seems like a song on that same wavelength, a bomb-ass night out just for its own sake. But this song does have one major element going for it that elevates it above its brethren, and that's that Mary J. Blige has been through some shit. Granted, most of it is kept implicit in the text of the song, but the fact is that just through the tone of her voice, you can tell that Mary J. isn't just some pampered pop diva. No, she's a real woman who has lived a full life which has not always been easy on her, so when you hear her talking about getting down and cutting loose, it draws your ear, and makes the party seem that much more profound as you realize just how important this night out free from drama is for Mary. For years, I felt that there was just something about this song that made it special which I couldn't quite put my finger on, and I think that's what it is. Tell me in the comments if you agree.
I'd like to make myself believe this planet Earth turns slowly.
This song takes the sound of childhood and captures it like fireflies in a jar. It's one of the purest, most magically uplifting pieces of music I've ever heard on the charts. Out of all the qualities we usually see in big hit songs, whimsy is not usually among them, but we all decided that it was worth engaging with our inner child just this once, and good lord, was it worth it. Also, this song is from an album called Ocean Eyes, so I guess that proves that Billie Eilish really was an industry plant all along. I don't have much to say about this one, not just because, again, I've got a Best Hit Songs of 2001 video in the works, but also because Fallen by Alicia Keys is one of the most straightforward songs of the decade. It's one of the most basic, technically flawless, and lusciously beautiful pieces ever to top the charts. Really, my only complaint about it is that it comes from an album called Songs in A Minor, an album which won a Grammy from the official US Recording Academy and is from a woman literally named Keys, and yet, this song is not in A minor. it's in E minor. If it were in A minor, it would sound like this. You're welcome. No, I was going to make a joke about how funny it is that one of the best number one hits of the 2000s was about a woman who looked like this flirting with a guy who looks like this. But apparently Timbaland is actually buff as shit these days after kicking a painkiller addiction and losing 130 pounds. So you know what? That's fucking incredible. You got nothing but my complete and total respect for that, my dude.
Feeling on me before you bring that on.
Bring that on.
You know what I mean.
I'm a freaky, shouldn't say those things.
But yeah, no, this song is fucking amazing. Timbaland has never been a particularly good singer, but he's definitely not lacking in charisma, and Nelly and Timbo's verbal ping-pong game of back-and-forth teasing is a joy to get sucked into, with an incredible earworm of a chorus and an instantly memorable twitchy synth line to tie the whole thing together. The song is apparently still big on TikTok to this day, and I'm not surprised. This is a song that only could have been made in 2006, but whose appeal will last forever. So, here we are. At long last, my top 10 favorite number one hits of the 2000s decade. It's been a long, winding road to get here, so I'm sure you're now wondering who could possibly have the honor of opening up the final stretch.
Oh my god! It's Lady Gaga!
Just dance, it's gonna be okay.
...2009 just hit different, man. I don't think that's just nostalgia talking either. I have way more fond memories of Bad Romance than I do for this song, but while Bad Romance is honestly kinda hard to go back to these days, Just Dance has aged like a fine glass of red wine. Convict. Gaga. This truly is one of the best dance songs about a party breaking down ever made, and it's a damn shame that most people these days who hear the name Just Dance think you're referring to this fucking thing right here. Oh, and by the way, I know that last time I made fun of Just Dance, a lot of people got mad at me, but before you attack me for implying that this series is nothing but a soulless, repetitive cash grab, let me point out that it was still getting new entries on the Wii up until 2020, and it was still releasing new games on Google Stadia until literally right now. So please ask yourself if you think this is an argument you can really win. This is Timbaland's best beat of the decade, full stop. If someone asked me to name a perfect pop song, a song that does everything right with no room for improvement in any area, Say It Right by Nelly Furtado is one of the first examples that pops into my head. Every listen of this song makes you feel like you're in a dream, enveloped by swirling clouds of mist with fascinating yet indistinct chatter echoing in from somewhere unseen, making you wonder what could be out there. Outside of her beautiful hook, Nelly knows to keep her presence to a minimum and just let the beat do its thing. It is a perfect song that couldn't have come out at any other time than the late 2000s, and there are 8 more songs on this list that I love more than it, starting with...
But you put on quite a show, really had me going, but now it's time to go.
I've talked at some length before about how completely overdone songs about cheating were on the pop charts in the 2000s. So many songs from this decade, especially the first half, were by either men cheating or women who were either suspicious or heartbroken at their men's infidelities, that it painted a really nasty, sour portrait of what relationships were in pop culture during this time. When I hear Take a Bow by Rihanna, I hear all of that ugliness being wrapped up in a balloon and then being released, floating up to the heavens with a massive sigh of relief. This song represents the curtain fall on the cheating age of pop music. Rihanna isn't suspicious, nor is she depressed, nor is she even really angry. She's just done.
Talking about girl, I love you, you're the one. This just looks like a refund. Please, what else is on?
She may have gotten played, but it's over now. Time for you to take a bow and exit stage left. This is the best possible way I want to hear this topic covered in pop music. I think you're cheating, so I'm gonna get suspicious and accusatory and chew you out over it? No, that's not an argument that I, as a listener, want to be stuck in the middle of. You cheated on me, and now I'm gonna mope about it? Understandable, but not at all what I want. But you cheated on me, so go fuck yourself. I have better things to do than waste my life on someone as pathetic as you? That's a sentiment that I can get behind. This is all delivered through a beautiful stripped-back piano composition, with Rihanna displaying a truly legendary level of relatability and emotional honesty. Umbrella may have been the song that solidified Rihanna as a superstar, but Take a Bow is the song that solidified her as a truly special artist to me.
When I told her, I said,
for a year in popular music where literally not one white person held the number one spot on Billboard, I can't think of a better crowning jewel for the music of 2004 than a glorious showcase of the absolute dominance of Atlanta by the king of R&B, the king of the guest feature, and the king of crunk. This song deservedly elevated Usher from music superstar to pop culture legend. And it's not a song that I feel any particular reason to heap praise onto. Everyone knows that it can get a crowd on its feet and bring back the spirit of 04 just as effortlessly today as the moment it was released. Honestly though, the most impressive thing about any of this is that Lil Jon was able to get not one, not two, but three of the biggest smash hits of 2004 by just recycling parts of this same song over and over again. Because you can definitely hear parts of Yaz's melody in this. And he basically used the same beat again verbatim for this. So yeah, even when this song was broken down and sold for parts, the parts also managed to become huge smash hits. I mean, no wonder this hit as big as it did.
Oh, Eminem, why did your mom make you spaghetti? She knew tonight was rap battle night.
Considering that most of Eminem's number one hits are, oh, what's a polite way of putting it, awful poopy stinky baby garbage, I'm so glad that he managed to top the charts with at least one absolute beast of a pump-up anthem. The discussion of whether Eminem deserves to be called a legend of hip-hop is one that tends to get incredibly heated incredibly quickly, but regardless of which way you swing on that, I think we can all agree that Lose Yourself is a big point in favor of that claim. I obviously don't think that Hey Ya by Outkast is the best number one hit of the decade, even if it is pretty damn close, but let me be clear. If I were judging a song based on how good each of its individual pieces are, Hey Ya would absolutely dominate the top spot of this list. This is another case where the song isn't more than the sum of its parts are just that good. It just piles on iconic moment after iconic moment, one after another. The bridge of Hey Ya literally spouts out What's Cooler Than Being Cool, Alright 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 Alright, and Shake It Like a Polaroid Picture, all within 30 seconds of each other. I say what's cooler than being cool. Andre didn't have to go this hard with this one, and yet he did, and here we are. Hey Ya is another song that doesn't really need me to break it down for nothing, huh? So instead, the only thing I'm gonna comment on is that it's utterly inconceivable to me that there was ever a time where Lucy Liu had even remotely comparable pop culture relevance to Beyonce. Now all Beyonce's and Lucy Liu's, shaking baby dolls, shake it off the floor. I mean, I know Lucy Liu was one of the biggest celebrities in the world at the time. I've already crossed paths with her once in this countdown, but it's still hard to get my head around considering that Beyonce these days is the omnipotent symbol of everything good, mighty, and beautiful about womanhood, while Lucy Liu is the snake from Kung Fu Panda. Guess what? It's gonna be May. Oh my god, you're right. It is gonna be May in just 10 short months. And you know what? Since I was born in May, I think this song deserves to go into the excellent tier because it produced me. Fuck self-deprecation. I deserve to go into the excellent tier. Although I don't quite deserve to go into... Okay, look. This next one is probably not gonna make a lot of sense to you guys. Probably gonna think that I'm absolutely crazy for putting it this high. God knows I didn't expect it to go this high when I started making this. But hey, I guess that anything is possible. Oh, when you I Believe by Fantasia is not a more iconic, more beloved, or even better put together song than Hips Don't Lie or Hey Ya or any of the other classics we've already talked about. You could make an argument that it shouldn't even count for this list. It only debuted at number one because of American Idol, and it fell off the charts so quickly that it didn't even make a Billboard year-end list. By all outward appearances, I Believe is the same as any other American Idol winner's single, just an incredibly straightforward, overly simple song meant to tug at your heartstrings with an almost comically on-the-nose attempt to be inspirational and uplifting, and it worked. When I heard this song, I finally got it. I finally understood. This is the song that all those other American Idol songs were trying to be this entire time. I was covered in goosebumps after the first time I listened to this, and more than a year later, I still get goosebumps with every single listen. And that's not something I could say about almost any other song that I've ever heard. Fantasia Barrino had an incredibly rough 19 years of life before American Idol, and while knowing about the hardship she overcame does implicitly make anything she sings more powerful, the thing is that I knew that she came from a troubled background even before I looked it up, purely through the way that pain and the strength she found to overcome it are infused into her voice. When I hear I Believe, I hear the sound of a woman's dreams actually, genuinely coming true. The sound of a passion that had been buried by reality finally allowed to resurface. The sound of a lifetime of hardship and struggle finally, finally paying off. It's a sensation that hundreds, even thousands of songs have tried and failed to capture, and yet, she got it. Through her uniquely inflected voice, welling with a bottomless passion, Fantasia somehow managed to take one of the most trite, overdone, eye-roll-worthy concepts in all of popular music and actually imbuing it with the impossibly high level of meaning that it demands. I've talked so much shit about faux inspirational attempts at empty feel-goodism over the course of this channel, but this isn't faux anything. It's a song that's so beautiful, powerful, and uplifting that it has the power to destroy cynicism. And I think it definitely earns the rare designation of being a truly exceptional piece of music. So, yeah, you can just stop making this kind of song now. I mean, we have the one. We don't need any more. Please. And now that we've got that out of the way, I'm just gonna kind of speed through these next three songs because, yeah, they're already beloved classics. I don't think anyone is gonna argue that these three songs are worthy of joining the less than 20 songs over the past 5 years that I've called exceptional. Smooth was the first number one hit of the 2000s decade, and it felt like a grand ribbon-cutting ceremony ushering in the new millennium. A team-up between one of the most iconic bands of the 20th century with a post-grunge vocalist representing the new era the world was stepping into. As much praise as the masterful Latin production on this song deserves, gets. I don't think Rob Thomas deserves to be overlooked either.
You got the kind of loving that can be so smooth, yeah. Give me your heart, make it real, or else forget about it.
There's just something magical about his rich, over-emotive, kind of ridiculous voice. He's just so damn deep into it and doesn't give a fuck how goofy he comes across. And when you combine that with the classic soaring guitar work of Carlos Santana, you wind up with a truly timeless experience.
And yes, I will be present on the first day of school and graduation.
I'm sorry, Miss Jackson.
Ooh, I am for real.
As great as both Big Boy and Andre 3000 are as individual artists, there's a reason why Outkast as a duo are one of the most beloved acts in the history of hip-hop, and Miss Jackson is their magnum opus as a pair. Aside from the cool experimental hip-hop production, this is one of the most human rap songs, or hell, one of the most human number one hits I've ever heard. Looking at the complex aftermath of a relationship that fell apart through the lens of one man's conversation with his ex's mother. For the record, this song was inspired by Andre's relationship with Erykah Badu, and apparently her mom absolutely loved the song and bought all of Outkast's merchandise based on it, and yeah, I can see why. While there are obviously still some ugly feelings on display, the song on hold is just so wholesome and determined to do right by his family no matter the cost, only highlighted by the genius production and vocal contributions of both members. Miss Jackson is a song that almost seems too good to be a number one hit, though not quite as much as... Yep, surprise, surprise, Viva La Vida is the best number one hit of the 2000s, who could have guessed? Considering that this is the number one spot, you're probably expecting me to go on a huge tangent about why, but, I mean, it's Viva La Vida by Coldplay. Every other song that I've put in this exceptional tier are among the best songs I've ever heard in my life, and yet Viva La Vida still takes the top spot in this ranking by an enormous margin. This is the kind of song where you remember where you were the first time you heard it, and the reasons why it's so incredible are actually genuinely too many to count.
Revolutionary sway.
I could go on for ages about this song if I let myself, but really, all you need to do to prove that Viva La Vida deserves to be here is to just listen to it. So go do that. you deserve it. Viva La Vida is a song too good for the charts, too good for the band who made it, and definitely, without question, too good for the general public to be trusted with.
I hear Jerusalem, bells are ring-a-dinging, Roman cavalry, oh, my choir's singing.
That's right. Viva La Vida was given an extra rap verse by the Want You Back girl, and yet the song still managed to survive without being ruined for everybody forever. If that doesn't convince you that Viva La Vida is the best number one hit of the 2000s, nothing will.
Never an honest word, but that was when I ruled the world.
I want Lance Bass to sit on my Lance face. And there we have it. We have finally completed our countdown of every single number one hit song of the 2000s decade. This was a massive undertaking, and I'd like to thank all of you for sticking with me until the end. Be sure to leave me a like, subscribe to the channel, and hit the bell for notifications of new uploads, and leave a comment discussing anything you want to about this video, the number one hits of the 2000s, or literally anything else. I'm just gonna keep saying it in every video. The more engagement I get, the better chance I have at Algorithm Daddy being kind to me, so thank you so much for your interaction. As always, this video was made possible by my supporters on Patreon. For just $1 per video, you'll get your name in the end credits of every video I make, while for $2, or the price of just a cup of coffee every time I upload, you'll get to suggest and vote for what songs I talk about on my channel in my Grab Bag Reviews series. $5 patrons get to join my Discord server and hang out, talk and play games with me and a ton of other cool people. $10 patrons get early access to my videos before they premiere, as well as personalized character art in the end credits of every video, which you can see above. And my $20 top patrons get to directly pick out any song in the world for me to do a guaranteed discussion on in each new episode of Grab Bag Reviews. In addition, every patron in every tier has an equal chance to be selected to give a patron review of the music I talk about in every main series video, so let's see what my patrons have to say about the number one hits of the 2000s. From Emily Malik regarding It's Gonna Be Me by NSYNC.
It's Gonna Be Me by NSYNC has an excellent production, but I always had an issue with the lyrics. It's about a guy who's forcing a girl into a relationship that she clearly doesn't want to be in. However, whenever the song comes on, I push my criticism aside and enjoy it for what it is, a great early 2000s boy band track.
From Kanubo regarding Fireflies by Owl City, this song is interesting in that it is unlike any other song that went number one around the time it was released. I mean, who would expect a song like this where imagination and amnesia are described in such wonderful metaphor to have ever become a smash hit, let alone reach the number one spot? Songs like this that existed before haven't been quite as lucky, but I'm glad this one did, and I wouldn't trade the world for this moment. From Toriana Frazier regarding Low by Flo Rida featuring T-Pain, I was 15 when this song came out, and I know it was a song that helped move me from a classic rock aficionado to becoming a lover of current pop music. Don't know what this song is about, but I absolutely love it. Don't care about the lyrics being garbage, the song makes me want to dance. From Liam Coles regarding Amazed by Lone Star, as a filthy Brit, I want to highlight the astonishing UK chart run of the time, spending 17 weeks in the top 40 without once cracking the top 20, yet placing 69th on the year end for 2000, the year when Robert the Construction Worker reigned supreme at number 1. I can only assume it was the Captain mix that took off here with its GPKC, gloriously pointless key change, that makes it, for me at least, a pleasant listen that unsurprisingly remains a staple at weddings to this day. And last but not least, from Shirley Stupid regarding Makes Me Wonder by Maroon 5, considering that songs about Jane turns 20 years old this month, I'd like to congratulate Maroon 5 on going a full 2 decades without making a single good song. Songs like Make Me Wonder, Won't Go Home Without You, and Moves Like Jagger are all decent, but in my opinion, nothing good has come out of this band past Harder to Breathe. Thank you all for your support, and thank you all for joining me on this journey through time. It's been a wild one. I'm Sean Fay-Wolfe at Diamond Axe Studios. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you next time. Take care.
I'm closer to where I started. I'm chasing after you. I'm falling even more in love with you. Letting go of all I've held on to. I'm standing here until you make me move. I'm hanging by a moment here.
By the way, this is not an effect or anything. This is like, I literally went to the store and just bought 24 jars of jelly specifically for this gag. Could I have just photoshopped 24 things of jelly in? Now that I say it out loud, yes, I definitely could have done that. But, you know what? Fuck you.